I've had some hills to climb. I've had some weary days. And some lonely nights. But when I look around and I think things over, you know what? All of my good days outweigh my bad days. I won't complain. Sometimes the clouds hang low. I can hardly see the road. I ask the question, Lord, why so much pain? But He knows what's best for me. Although my weary eyes, they can't see. So I'll just say, thank you, Lord. I won't complain. God has been so good to me. Has He been good? He's been good to me. More than this whole world, all you could ever be. He's been so good. Tell me, you know what He did? He dried all of my tears away. Turn my midnight into day. So I'll just say, thank you, Lord. I've been lied on, but thank you, Lord. I've been talked about, but thank you, Lord. I've been misunderstood, but thank you, Lord. You might be sick, body rocking with pain, but thank you, Lord. The bills are due, don't know where the money coming from, but thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I won't. Yeah. I won't complain. It dries. Every one of my tears away. Turn my midnight in today. So instead of complaining, I learned how to lift them hands, look up toward heaven, and say, thank you, Lord. Tell Him, thank you, Lord. 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 I won't complain. I won't complain. I know it's time to go home. but I won't complain. I used to, but I won't. I could, but I won't. Complaining. Some of y'all been mumbling. Some of y'all been grumbling. But you ought to thank God for bringing you this far. You ought to thank God for bringing you from a mighty long way. And you're alright. And you're alright. You ought to stand on your feet and praise the Lord.
Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Before I ask for you to do anything for anybody, Lord, to just do anything, period, I just want to thank you for another day. I want to thank you for one more time. I want to thank you because the blood is still running warm in our veins today. Lord, thank you, Lord, for just being you. Thank you, Lord, for just being you. Thank you for being merciful. Thank you for being long-suffering. Lord, thank you for watching over us, protecting us from danger seen and unseen. My God, you know some of the lifestyles that we live. It's contrary to your word. It's contrary to your will. It's contrary to your holiness. But my God, not because we're good, not because we're righteous, not because, Lord, of how gamed up we are. Lord, we're still here because you keep renewing your mercy one more time. And Lord, for that, we're thankful. We give you gratitude for the multitude of things that you've done. My God, you keep making a way out of no way. Lord, you keep showing out in your love. My God, whatever we do, whatever we say, you know how we get ignorant sometimes. You know how we get arrogant sometimes. You know how we get egotistical sometimes. Lord, we don't walk in the spirit of humility all the time. And my God, you know us. You know the F's on our report card. You know, Lord, the facade that we put on in the world. But Lord, you really know us. You know what I mean? Everything. Things that our parents and best friends and people don't know. My God, you're omnipresent. You see the evil as well as the good. And Lord, with everything that we've done, with everything that we said in our lives, you still continue to be merciful. You still continue to love us. You still continue to keep us here. You still keep waking us up. And for that, we're thankful, Lord. The enemy wants us to go to hell on a scholarship. Our enemies want us to be in prison. Lord, our enemies, if it was up to our enemies, we would have been dead a long time ago. But my God, you keep being merciful. You keep being long-suffering. And Lord, for that, we thank you. Lord, we praise you. Lord, we magnify you. Lord, we glorify you one more day. Now, Lord, before I go into my message, I want you to touch the minds of the people. You know the needs of the people. You see things, Lord, that I could never see. My God, open up my eyes that I may see. Lord, as a fool, Lord, as currently right now as a backslider, I'm yielding myself as a yielded vessel, asking for you to use me so I can say something to touch the minds of those that's bound by the spirit of depression, bound by the spirit of procrastination, bound by the spirit, Lord, you understand me, I feel like a failure. Lord, let me say something. Let me minister something to get them out of that. Lord, let the spirit of encouragement come out of my mouth. Lord, let the spirit of enlightenment come out of my mouth. Somebody feeling suicidal on this morning. Somebody feeling depressed on this morning. Somebody doing drugs on this morning. Lord, use me. Lord, use a fool. Lord, use a backslider. Lord, use this idiot, Lord, to say something. Lord, that can touch the minds and hearts and souls of man today. Lord, I yield myself and humble myself before you. Lord, in front of the people, Lord. Lord, use me, Lord. The young man that was a special ed student that would come out of learning disability and behavior disorder from the south side of Chicago. Lord, they said I wouldn't make it to C18. But my God, because of your love, Lord, I'm still here. My God, right now, Touch the minds of the people. I don't know, Lord. Somebody might have went to court and heard something that they didn't want to hear. And Lord, they depressed because of that. Lord, give me something to say to them. Lord, somebody went to parole and didn't get, you know what I mean, their parole. They went to a parole hearing and Lord, it was rejected. My God, give me something to say to him. Somebody might be listening, Lord, that's currently and hopefully temporarily in prison, serving a life sentence. And the enemy is telling them that he gonna die in prison. My God, give me something to say, Lord, to him. Lord, there may be a mother that lost her son due to gun violence. Lord, give me something to say, Lord, to her. It might be a woman that might have got raped, might got molested, touched inappropriate, Lord, by her father, people within the family. Lord, give me something to say, Lord, to her. Lord, my God, it might be a man, Lord, that was touched, that was molested, that was raped. And because of that, Lord, he feels like he just can't go on. Give me something to say, Lord, to him. Lord, right now, it might be a father, Lord, that feel like he less than a man. He don't feel like a man because he don't feel like he can provide, Lord, for his family. Give me something to say, Lord, to him. Word my mouth, Lord. Use me, Lord, as a yielded vessel to speak to those that's feeling depressed and give me words of encouragement, Lord, to bring them out of that. All I need is your word, Lord. For you, your word, Lord, is a lamp unto the feet of the saints. It's a light unto their path. Lord, I heard David say, and the Spirit spake by me because his word was in my tongue. Lord, I know your word is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and joints and marrow and discerner of thoughts and intents of hearts, Lord. Lord, I know that man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeded out of the mouth of God. Lord, we need that word. We need the breakfast, lunch, and dinner of champions, Lord. Lord, give me thy word on today that I may minister unto thy people, Lord. Now, Lord, make a way out of no way for that single mother, Lord, that don't know where the next meal is coming from, but presiding over those children. Look over that single father, Lord. The mother died or the mother on drugs or whatever the problem may be. I know that you're the problem solver. Make a way out of no way for him and those children. Look out for the homeless. Look out for the friendless. Comfort those that are in need of comfort right now, Lord. Lord, in all these things we ask, let thy will be done. Lord, let thy will be done in our lives, Lord. Lord, you're working everything out for the good in spite of the situation, in spite of the current tribulation that we in. My God, you're still worthy of the praise. If I had innumerable tongues, it still wouldn't be enough to praise thy name. Now, Lord, all these things we ask in the name of Yaharashai. And Lord, we call them things which be not as though they were. We know that faith is the substance of things hoped for and evidence of things not seen. And we ask you to move on today, Lord. In the name of Yaharashai, we ask these things. Amen. Blessings to everybody, man. Come on up in here, man. Hit that like button. Yeah. Come on up in here and hit that like button, man. Blessings to everybody. Shout out to Rob. I know you're used to that. Hey, man, come on up in here, man. Hit that like button. Yeah, get them likes up. Greet one another. Yeah. No matter how you feeling right now, hopefully after this word come through, you'll feel a little better. Yeah. Blessings to everybody, though, man. I'm glad that you're here. Yeah, I know, Rob, that took you back. I know that brought back memories, huh? Yeah. Teenagers in the Word. You know, it haven't always been sinful to pee. You know, Rob Bass, he remember when it was Minister Gilmore. He remember when I was in Christ, when I was saved, living in holiness. Amen. But get them likes up, man. Man, bro, back in high school, you already know. Gangbangers giving their life to God. And you know what I mean? People asking questions. You know what I mean? Leaving the cafeteria, coming to the library at Dunbar Vocational High School to ask me questions, man. You know? Yeah, those were the days. Appreciate that, bro. Appreciate the 10. Bill, good looking for the 2. Oh, you talking about my grandfather and God. You talking about Bishop R.L. Mitchell. Yeah, everybody knew my father in the Lord was Elder Donald L. Mosley. That's my father in the Lord. I still call him to this day. You know what I mean? I appreciate the man of God because even while I've been backslidden, he never stopped answering the phone for me. Amen. And to his dying day, Bishop Mitchell always showed me love. You know what I mean? Just like his own grandson, Bishop R.L. Mitchell. Sometime when y'all get a chance, you could go to YouTube and just put in Bishop or Apostle R.L. Mitchell, Old Landmark Church of God in Christ. And you will see some of the influences that I've had, you know what I mean, as a young man. You know, even when I would call myself, you know what I mean, game banging and things like that, in special ed, you know what I mean, learning disability, behavior disorder. You know what I mean? Bishop never looked down on me, man. Always treated me like a grandson. Elder Mosley always treated me, you know what I mean, like a son, man. You know what I mean? So I had the best of both worlds. I appreciate being raised in holiness. Appreciate the five, fam. Good looking. Y'all get them likes up, man. I need this message to go out. I appreciate the contributions, but the greatest contribution that you can give to me is hitting the like button so some young man that's feeling suicidal or feeling discouraged or feel like he can't go on, or some young woman that been raped or, you know what I mean, touched inappropriately, you know what I mean, feeling like she's less of a woman. Yeah, get this out. Hit that like button. Share this video. But blessings to everybody, man. I'm glad that you're here. Before I even get started, I want you to know that I'm glad that you're here. You know, truly. If nobody told you that on today, I am so glad, you know what I mean, that God has blessed you, you know what I mean, to be here. Seriously. Now, before I get started, let me say this, man. A lot of my consultations be because people be in depression, man. Everything don't be about, you know, pimping and hoeing and things. Appreciate that 10. Appreciate that 10, darling. Thank you. Thank you. Everything don't be about the lifestyle. You know, I have people in the game and outside the game, you know, going through, man, all type of spirits. I remember one young pimp even told me one time, I said, brother, you got to get out that spirit and you got to get out that quick. I remember him telling me, he said, P, you know, sometime I feel like I had more peace when I was in prison. I said, you got to be careful what you say out your mouth. Amen. You can speak your judgment into existence. You can speak, you know what I mean, your circumstance in existence. You got to watch what you say. And the reason why I say that is because I was young and foolish at one time, and I wasn't a convict. And I just remember joking around, playing, and Freeze didn't think that was funny because Freeze was a convict. And, you know, one of the homies, he was on Swole. You know, I was like, man, it looked like everybody, man, that come out the pen be on Swole. Man, maybe I need to come through the pen, you know what I mean? So I come out, you know, on Swole. And because Freeze was kind of like, bro, he like, don't play like that. Yeah, P, don't play like that. So we have to watch, you know, what we say. You know, we got to watch what we say. We got to watch, you know what I mean, what we say out of our mouths. And as men, you know, no matter what we feel, you know what I mean? We can't release that out of our mouths. Amen? Because, you know, Yaharashad, which y'all call Jesus, you know what I mean? He said that in this world, we're going to have tribulation. So no matter what your lifestyle is, you're going to go through something. Amen? You promised to go through something. So as men, we have to mentally respond. We leaders, we have to be able to lead beyond pain. You know, as the great Andre Taylor said, we got to be able to lead beyond pain. That's what a leader is. Amen. And during that time when we in pain and we going through something, we got to learn how to shut our mouths and be still. Amen. And see that God is God and let him fight the battle. Amen. But I want to, you know, deal with certain issues today that normally don't get, you know, it really don't. It don't get, you know, because, of course, when you're in the game, you have to be the embodiment of perfection. You have to represent that. You have to, you know, be bigger than life. Amen. And a lot of times in the lifestyle, you know, people tend to get arrogant, or they get so much into the character or the image, you know, that they have conformed to, you know, that they forget about, you know, reality. You know, so let's deal with some things on today, you know, and we're going to deal with it, too, according to, you know, his word. You know, because many of you are in depression for certain reasons. And if you notice that when I was praying, not only did I pray for the women who are in depression, you know, for being molested or raped, I had to talk about the men. Because, of course, that's not, nobody cares about a man being touched inappropriately. You know, and some of you, yes, let's just deal with it. Some of you, you know what I mean, is fighting against the existence of believing in a God because of the things that happened to you in your childhood. Some of you was touched, some things happened to you, and you just feel like, you know, if God really loved me, you know, why did that happen to me? Why did that, you know, situation transpire, you know, in my life? I'm talking to men, you know, and of course, you know, you don't get on social media, you know, man, because I told you it's a difference between somebody who's a hustler and somebody who actually went through that and they're hurting from that, you know, so nobody knows about that. But I want to say, because a lot of you have not mentally got past that, emotionally got past that, spiritually got past that. You know what I mean? That's still, you know, hindering you in your growth in life and in the lifestyle or whatever lifestyle you're participating in, because the burdens of that particular, you know, event still has a residence in the location of your mind. You know, appreciate that. Thank you. I appreciate the 50. It still has a residence in your mind. You know, and a lot of times you get suicidal because, you know, you were touched. And let's just deal with it. Let me just kick the door down. Some of you was touched, you know, by somebody that your mama trusted. So you have a lot of resentment and anger towards women because you have anger towards your mother, because you feel like your mother didn't protect you. Your mother basically gave you to just anybody. Your mama just allowed anybody to watch over you. And as a result of your mother allowing anybody to watch over you, that's why you was raped. That's why you was molested. So you feel suicidal at times. You know what I mean? Because of what transpired in your life. And your mind is completely bombarded. You have the burdens of those events that transpired. Some of you went to a church of God in Christ. Oh, let's talk about it. Some of you went to a church of God in Christ. Some of you went to a Baptist church. And then let's also talk about that, because sin is omnipresent. Amen. It's in Islam. Amen. It's in Christianity. It's in Pentecostalism. It's in Roman Catholicism. You can't escape it. You got people with pedophile and hebephile and ebophile, you know, spirits in every denomination. So you can't go to a denomination and be like, oh, it don't exist here. No, you have nasty brothers. You got brothers that's got a perverted spirit in Islam and, you know, in Roman Catholicism, Baptist. It don't matter. Seventh-day Adventist. It don't matter. And because of these titles that these people had within that congregation, your mother trusted them and allowed you to be there, and you got touched. So, of course, you know, if you got that type of background, you know, a lot of times you don't want to hear nobody talking about God and ministering the word and all of that. You still have depression from that time in your life. You know, minister so-and-so did this to you, evangelist so-and-so, missionary did this to you, bishop did this, pastor did this. So you don't want to hear about no God. I'm just dealing with some issues. Let's walk for a minute. You know, some things happen. Then for some of you young girls and some of you older women, you know, your mama just allowed, you know, anybody, you know what I mean, to come, you know what I mean, into your life. Amen. Brother, if you need me to pray or do something, just call me, you know what I mean, after this. My number is 702-800-9473, bro. I don't mind. Amen. Blessings to you and your mother and your beloved family. 702-800-9473. Just call me, you know what I mean, after this message. And you know what I mean? We'll come on one accord. Amen. But yes, there are some things, you know what I mean, that has happened. You know, to you. And as a result of that, you 30-something, 40-something, some of you in your 50s, some of you in your 20s, you're still going through that because you was touched, you was molested. And let me just say this. You know, I was molested myself. Let's talk about it. You know what I mean? Sin was molested. Some of y'all already knew that. You know, but to some people that's new here, you know what I mean? I was molested. Only thing that separate me, and that's why I kicked the door down, and of course the people on the other side, they can't say the things that I said because it's a man that touched him. Let me teach you something. You know, I was a young boy when those things happened with me. And this was a woman that, you know what I mean, was almost pretty much 40 years old at that time. And I was a little boy. But because my stepfather, I looked at him, you know what I mean, as a gangster. I looked at him as an older influence and things like that. Even though he was my stepfather, he was like a big brother. So when we talked, he said, you know, you're not going to tell your mother because you're not no snitch. And not just that, you're not going to tell your mother because she's going to get the police involved. And what happened to you, it also happened to me. That happens to all the players. And so, of course, when he conveyed it to me like that, I was like, I'm a player? He's like, you a player. You know what I mean? Don't go crying to your mama because she going to sit up there and get the police all involved and all of that. And it's not that big of a deal. So let me just say this. When people got on Lil Boosie about him having that done to his son, let me just say this. Of course, when people get on social media, they tend to act different. You know, but people in the streets know that this is common behavior. You know, abnormal, but common behavior in the ghetto. My uncle, when it come to my uncle, you know what I mean? Yes, my uncle lost his virginity to a prostitute because his father said he wasn't raising no fags. So that's how my uncle lost his virginity to a prostitute. You know what I mean? In the ghetto, you know what I mean? That's common. In the ghetto, if you got touched or had some early experiences with a girl or a grown woman, you know what I mean? If your father was a hood nigga, yes, you know what I mean? He was happy of that. He was proud of that. So, of course, we in a different era now and we on social media. And I'm not saying it's wrong or right, but that which Lil Boosie had done, anybody that's in the hood that live in the ghetto, you already know this is common behavior. This is very common. And you got people already knowing, they sitting up there letting you know, this sin ain't lying. This is common behavior. A father might hear about his young son getting head or something, and immediately he get happy. And in the day we living in, you got so many guys, little boys and guys, you know, want to get involved in homosexuality. I just got to keep it 100, you know, I sometimes understand, you know, because that spirit is on the rampage. But what I will say is when that spirit, when that child is molested, you don't know what could happen. You don't know how that child's flesh will respond to that demon when that demon come to knock on the door. That's why we have children that's promiscuous. That's why we have young girls already involved in prostitution. That's why we got some boys that's already involved in homosexuality because they was touched. Something happened that was contrary to that which was right at an early age, you know? And sometimes, like we've been saying, you know what I mean? Sometimes them homosexuals, they'll tell you that they was born like this because they don't want to talk about some things that happened, you know what I mean, in their childhood. So they tell you that, you know, I was born like this. I always was, you know, like this. But they're not going to go into, you know, father did this to me. Uncle did this to me. Pastor did this. Bishop did this. The older man that mama trusted in the community, he did this. You know, mama's boyfriend did this. You know what I mean? When mama was at work, mama boyfriend used to do this and do this to me. You know, so without going into all of that, you know, they pretty much deceived themselves and endeavored to deceive you into thinking that they was born like that. But no, they wasn't born like that. Something happened. That's a learned behavior. Something happened, you know, that they don't want to talk about. And you know what I mean? And we hope that, you know, the healing and deliverance power of God delivered them out of that. But let's just talk about me right quick. Before we get on anybody, let's deal with that. You know, after, you know what I mean, she put her mouth on me, I'm just going to tell it like it is. See, they tell you on YouTube, you got people talking about how they was molested and things like that, but they never really go into it, you know, because some of them, you know what I mean, was touched by guys and things like that. But I'm going to say something that most people who were molested never tell you, you know, but I'm going to tell you the truth. The truth is, I liked it. The truth is, my flesh liked it. As the Apostle Paul said in Romans 7:18, for I know that in me that is in my flesh dwelleth no good thing. There is no good thing in the flesh. Amen. And when that happened to me, my flesh liked it. I wanted it to happen again, especially now after my stepdad confirmed that this was cool. This, I'm a player. You know, now I like this. You know what I mean? I didn't even, let me, can I just talk to y'all for a minute? Can I just be myself? You know what I mean? Or do I gotta do a Christian pretend? Do I gotta, you know, pretend like they do in church? Or can I just be 100 with y'all? Can I just keep it 100? Can we talk? Look, man, I didn't even have, you know, sin didn't even have a dick then. I had a penis, but you know what I mean? I'm all up in the mirror, man. You know what I mean? Checking me out like, man, I'm grabbing it now and, you know, stroking it now. And you know what I mean? And now I'm looking at myself. I say, oh, man, you know what I mean? I look good. Not only that, now I'm in the bathtub. Now my mama, she finally figuring out, you know, why Philip always want to be in the bathtub now? Why is he always running the water? And the reason why I'm running the water is because I'm trying to feel, you know what I mean, that feeling that Miss Banyard gave me with her mouth. I'm trying to feel that feeling. You know what I mean? I want that feeling again. You know what I mean? So now when I'm in the bathtub, I turn on the water and I'm putting my little pee-pee, I'm putting my penis, man, you know what I mean, by this water because I want to feel that feeling again. You know what I mean? What that song said, do it again. The Staple Singers, do it again. Yeah, I'm trying to do it again. You know what I mean? I'm putting my pee-pee all up in the water, man. I want to feel that feeling again. You know? So that me being, you know, molestation led me into the spirit. Follow me now. The spirit of that molestation, you know what I mean, led me into masturbation. I wasn't masturbating before that, you know what I mean, happened to me. But after that happened, you know what I mean, them other demons came to visit me. Other demonic spirits, other sexual, sinful spirits, you know what I mean, came to visit me, you know, and minister to my flesh. And I complied to it as a young boy, you know. So now, you know what I mean, I'm 8 years old, you know what I mean, already playing with myself. Yeah. I'm already, man. I'm trying to go hard in the paint too. And you know what's so cold? And y'all about to sit up here and laugh, but this is real. Why, when I started masturbating, I thought I was the only one in the world doing this. I remember as a little boy, I thought I was Christopher Columbus. I thought I discovered something. I thought that I discovered masturbation. You know what I mean? I thought I discovered this. I was like, wow, you know what I mean? This is sensational. You know, this feels good. I don't think the world knows about this. Man, I was just having a good old time, right? You know what I mean? I'm like, man, you know, like, I don't think the world know this. Mama and all of them don't know about this, man. This feel good. You know, I done discovered a revelation as a little boy. So of course, as I evolved, you know, I found out that, you know, other people been doing it before I was born. But at that time, man, I really thought that I had discovered a new revelation. I was like, man, the world don't know about this. What that song, Franchise Boys, bitch can't do it like this. Bet you can't do it like this. Bet you can't do it like this. Nope. Bet you can't do it like this. Nope. I really thought that I had discovered something. You know what I'm saying? But man, I came to find out, man, y'all was already masturbating, you know what I mean, before I had even took off. You dig? Man. And I had even, shout out to Sharon Wimbush, we had been talking about this. Listen, you know what I mean? Some of y'all already know this story, but I'm about to get deep. You know, those of you that's from Chicago, you already know what it is. Don't act strange on me now. But I'll never forget it. Now that freaky demon is all over me. See, I'm doing something that most pastors don't do. They like to talk about people all in the congregation in the world. Let's talk about Philip Brandon Gilmore right quick. Let's talk about my nasty, ungodly, unrighteous, sinful flesh, right? Check it out. So look, you know, as I'm going on my masturbation journey, you know, I done became a seasoned vet at an early age with the masturbation. Now the demon's in me. Now I'm ready to step it up. Tell somebody, say, step it up. I'm trying to step it up now. You know, now watch this. And this goes back to mothers working jobs. Now, of course, mama was working jobs at the time. Only Chicago people know what I'm talking about. At the time, mama was working countless hours at Illinois Bell. You know what I mean? Mama wasn't in the streets no more. She had given her life to God. No earrings, no makeup, no pants, you know, sanctified, right? Check it out. So mama working countless hours, you know what I mean, at Illinois Bell. And she used to have me stay at, I forgot her first name, but it was Miss Williams' house. And she had a daughter named Tamiko. Tamiko was pretty, but I really wanted her big sister. Her sister was fine and light-skinned with just a big old booty with long hair. She was just fine, because you know, in the city of Chicago, my era, you know what I mean, we was trained to go after the light-skinned, you know, or the brown. You know what I mean? Yeah, the darkies, you know what I mean? We was with the dark-skinned girls, you know what I mean, at nighttime. We was taught like that. We was taught to be ignorant. If you look at all of our Chicago songs, it always talk about being with a red bone, or talk about, you know, light skin and things like that. You know, it wasn't until I came to the West Coast that chocolate just got a hold of me. Touch somebody and say, them chocolate women just started getting a hold of me. You know what I mean? Got me some dark skin coochie. You know, never been the same since. But anyway, look, check it out. So, okay, look. You know, I would go over Miss Williams' house and we would wrestle all the time, me and Tamiko. She was like a little tomboy, you know, but this is how sin got involved in sexual, you know, sins at a very early age. Tell somebody, say the enemy had a plan for sin at an early age. So anyway, look, check it out. So we're wrestling. This is when WWF was the thing, man. Ultimate Warrior, he was my favorite. Everybody was into Hulk Hogan. Sin was into the Ultimate Warrior, man. He was the man. So look, check it out. We wrestling, and one day, as we wrestling, she just on top of me, you know, and we just wrestling, but she on top of me, and you know, she's hitting me and things like that, but that freaky spirit just came over me. I stopped fighting. Huh? Yeah, I stopped fighting. Yeah, she was on top of me. I stopped wrestling with her. Uh-huh. She's hitting me, and he getting me all in the face, and she's just on top of me, and I ain't hitting back, because this starting to feel good to me. See, she didn't know, you know what I mean, that I had got involved in some early things. You understand me? Seasoned. But she was more seasoned than me. Check it out now. So she on top of me, you know what I mean? And she said, why you ain't hitting back? Why you ain't fighting back? And I'm just grinning, you know, with two dimples and things like that. And so she kissed me. And then we just started kissing. And, you know, because I remember everything, you know what I mean, like it just happened yesterday. Her breath was, you know, tart. You know, that's one thing about sin. You know, I'm always going to remember, you know, your breath. If your breath wasn't right with God, Jesus, you know, and the Holy Spirit, you know, I'm going to remember if your breath was out of the will of God. And even though I was freaky, and this kiss is feeling good. You're on top of me. I'm liking this body heat. You know what I mean? My little penis is getting on hard and everything like that. But baby, your breath is out of the will of God. Amen. Your breath smelling like the 13th chapter of Revelations. Amen. Your breath is the reason why the murders in Chicago is at an all-time high. But anyway, look, check it out, right? So, you know, we kissing and things like that. You know, my flesh loving it. You know, and this is how the enemy led her. This is how, now follow the story. You laughing, but follow the story. Watch this now. She tell me, I didn't tell her. She told me, get up. And I obeyed. I took heed to instruct. I ain't gonna lie. This is one time that a girl gave me instructions and I took heed. She said, get up. And I got up. You know what I mean? And she took my pants down. She took my mighty, I think I had on the He-Man drawers at that time too. Yeah, let's tell it all. Let's tell it all now. Sin had on them He-Man drawers. You know what I mean? Some of y'all are a little bit too old. I mean, some of y'all too young. You don't even remember He-Man. You know what I mean? But yeah, man, I had on them He-Man drawers, man. You know what I mean? Or I might have had on them Captain Planets. By your powers combined, I am Captain Planet. He's a hero. Gonna take pollution down to zero. You know what I mean? See, I might have had on the, you will pay for this, Captain Planet. You know, I might have had on them Captain Planet draws. So anyway, look, check it out. I take my Captain Planets down, or my He-Mans, whatever, and man, she just started doming me up. And hey, look, this is before Facebook and all of that. You know what I'm saying? I'm an 84, baby. Hey, look, check it out. Wasn't no social media, none of that. I didn't need nobody to give me the blueprint on what to do, like a young G. You know what I mean? I put my hands behind her head and guided her. That's how you know them demonic spirits was already there. But check it out. This is what you're not peeping game on. Who told her to do that? Because I was 8. And matter of fact, no. Yeah, I was 8 when that happened. And she was 11 because Tomiko had 3 years on me. So look, check it out. You know what I mean? Now, it's on a regular. Every time I come over to Miss Williams' house, man, I'm trying to get situated. That's what we used to say back in the shack. You know what I mean? When you hear a Chi-Town, dude say, you know, they call it Chi-Rack, but you know, I'm from Chi-Town. I ain't from Chi-Rack. I'm from Chi-Town. You did? You know, when a Chi-Town dude say, yeah, man, I'm about to get situated. Yeah. You know what I mean? She about to get me situated. If back in the day, when we said, when one of the moles say, yeah, man, you know what I'm saying? You know, what's going on with the 5? Oh, man, just got through getting situated. You know what I mean? I'm over, you know, she got me situated. Meaning that she just gave me that washing machine. She just gave me that baptism pool. You dig? Yeah, so, you know, no disrespect to the other organizations within the location, but when it came to, you know, slick talk and things like that, you know, the moles, man, the stones, we was just always, you know, on point. You know, the GDs, you know, was cool. You know, the BDs was dusty. Let's just keep it 100. You know, they didn't start coming up to the rapping and things like that, but they was dusty. They had a few ballers and things. But when people thought of slick talk, you know, being clean and being knowledgeable, man, it really was the moles. You know, if we're going to keep it 100, right? But look, check it out. You know what I mean? You know, I was talking about, you know what I mean, getting situated. You know what I mean? She getting situated. Every time I'm coming over Miss Williams' house, I'm getting situated. You dig? So I remember to this day, and this is how you know the spirit of fornication was just deep in R. Kelly's music. Because I just remember her, this by that time, you know what I mean, fast forwarding, you know what I mean, all the little girls, all the young girls, you know what I mean? Because she might have been like, I want to say 13 at the time. And I might have been like 10. You know what I mean? And this is when 12 Play was out. You know what I mean? And everything. I want to say this might have been like 94, 93, 94. I don't know. But man, I just remember her listening to that 12 Play. You know what I mean? And like I'm trying to tell you, ministering spirits, demonic spirit. spirits of fornication and everything was already in the music. That's why I laugh at society now trying to be self-righteous. You know what I mean? Trying to throw a man in prison and all that type of stuff. Y'all wasn't throwing that man in prison when he was making all of them hits. When y'all was sitting over there grinding and having a good time. Now that, you know, a dude old and stuff, now y'all acting different. But that's another subject. But anyway, yeah, man, I just remember, you know, man, how deep those spirits was. But I also remember even her at times getting depressed. And not just that, because I knew all her friends. All her friends were the same way. They had started getting busy real early, you know? And I can't help now that I'm older, you know what I mean, with discernment and knowledge and game and things like that. Now I can understand that a lot of the girls from my childhood, they had to have been molested too. They had to have been touched or seen something they ain't had no business seeing, or basically getting touched inappropriately. You know? And some of them same girls, you know what I mean, from the neighborhood, because, you know, I told y'all the streets that I came from, you know what I mean? Originally, you know what I mean, when I was a little kid, you know, we was on 62nd in St. Lawrence. Then we went from 62nd in St. Lawrence to Hyde Park. Then from Hyde Park, you know what I mean, we moved to 54th and Cottage Grove. From 54th and Cottage Grove, we went to 84th and Dante, which is by Blackstone. You know what I mean? So that was pretty much like my childhood, you know, locations that I stayed at, you know what I mean, during my childhood, right? So look, you know what I mean? All my experiences, you know what I mean? Now that I look at, you know what I mean, even at some of my friends who was young killers, you know what I mean, that would kill and pretty much listen to some gospel music afterward. And I'm talking about my cousin. You know, Lord knows what happened to my cousin. You know, and I'm thinking about, you know, certain people in the family. I don't know. Of course, hopefully God will, you know, allow us to get, you know, around each other physically so we could really talk. But yes, I had a cousin in my family. You know, of course, he's still locked up. You know what I mean? But at a very early age, you know what I mean? Of course, some of us was fighting and everything like that. But no, man, cuz was, he was putting that murder game down early. You know, early. He had a, it was just in him. You know, and because now that I think about certain conversations and certain things that he said, I can't help but to think that something might have happened to my cousin to make him the way that he was at a very early age. Because this, my cousin was the type, hey man, my cousin was the type, man, to delete a nigga, you know what I mean, on Wednesday, and on Friday night, he'll be at his mama's church playing the drums. You know what I mean? Shout, dancing in the aisle. And then, you know what I mean? Playing the drums. And then, you know what I mean? All throughout the week, man, he was BPSing crazy, man. You know what I mean? So, you know, I'm just telling you, you know, why a lot of children, you know, are like the way they are. Why certain people are like they way out. Of course, I had to just deal with that molestation demon, of course, because in the ghetto, these demons, these spirits, they're not dealt with, especially with young men, because it's not the thing to talk about, you know, an older person touching you or doing something to you that they had no business doing. You know, as a man, of course, we're taught, you know what I mean, in the streets, you know what I mean, to, you know, real niggas and gangsters and things like that, you don't got no business crying. So, you know, if we talk, you know what I mean, to be not be crying and, you know, and don't be soft. No real nigga that actually has some things happen to him, you know, is really going to convey them things. So we have a lot of older men that's on drugs and always angry and always depressed and always ready to kill, and people be like, what's wrong with him? And, you know, what's taking place? Why is he like this? I'm helping you understand. You know, because some of y'all never been touched. And thanks be to God. God has been protecting you and watching over you. You know what I mean? Your whole life. Amen. God has been good to you. You know what I mean? But this is just certain things that, you know, in the streets, of course, people never deal with. I'm going to give you something else before I go to another subject within my message. Hey, check this out. That's why I keep telling y'all, everybody is not hating on me. You understand what I'm saying? Watch this. That situation that transpired in 2008 when I did what I did ignorantly, you know, you have to understand that certain people were molested. Certain guys, even in the pimp game, was touched or something happened to them at an early age. So anything regarding, you know, a minor or a child, you know, being messed with, you know, of course, they're not going to come out and say it, but some of them have been touched. Some of their uncles and cousins and fathers and things did things that they had no business doing. So that's why, you know, I've talked to Freeze. And I said, man, at first, you know, when I was looking at it from my natural eye, I'm like, hey, man, why do acting like that? Why do speaking on it like that? Why is he emotionally reacting like that? Then when I opened up my game eyes, I had to realize that everybody is not hating on me. Some of these guys in the pimp game have been touched. Certain things happened in their childhood. So when they hear anything, they don't do diligent research to see, you know, if this is true or anything like that. No, they just automatically just get defensive. They just go off. They just emotionally react to it because they still have not healed from what happened to them. That's why I said everybody's not hating on me. All right. But what I want to say to those that have been molested, those that have been raped, those that, you know, things happen to you inappropriately, I just want to tell you this, you know, as someone who basically been molested myself, you know, all things work together, you know, for the good, whether you receive it or not. You know, if you get past, if you allow God to deliver you, if you allow God to minister to you right now, and you just cry out to God, because some of you went to social media for healing. Some of you go to the wrong people and the wrong things for healing and medication. You're coming to Facebook for medication. You're coming to Instagram for healing. You're making statuses and you're crying out for help. And I'm here to tell you that the streets and social media, man, they don't care nothing about you. What you doing? Why are you on Facebook making statuses, you know, revealing your vulnerabilities, giving people opportunities to manipulate and accumulate off of you? You better wake up to this game. Don't nobody care about you. Don't nobody love you. No. Get off social media, man, and get to God. That's what you need to do. Some of you be going on Facebook and you crying, and you, every status that you put on Facebook is a woe is me type of status. And you know what I mean, man, how come nobody don't call me? I know I know certain people right now on Facebook. I don't even go on their page. I'm still friends with them, but I unfollowed their page because I don't want to see no statuses of theirs coming down my timeline, because there is a spirit of depression, you know, that's manifesting every time they come down on the timeline. Every time you see them, it's, you know, I bet if I died today, you know what I mean, a lot of y'all will be happy. Or I bet if I died today, you know what I mean, some of y'all wouldn't even care. You know, the real ones know. You know, them type of statuses. I'm talking about every day, not every once in a while, just about every day they got something depressing to say. They're always going through something. You know, and I'm here to say, if you're one of those people, you're going to the wrong place. Amen. You need to go where the table is spread and where the feast of the Lord is going on. You need to get into the word of God. Amen. You need to cry out to God and say, Lord, what must I do to be delivered? What must I do to be saved? You need to sincerely get to God. You need to get off Facebook, get off Instagram, get off of these social media apps and sincerely, earnestly get to God. The streets don't care about you. Social media don't care about you. What you doing? Get to God. That's the generation we in now. They not trying to get to God. They trying to get the social media. And social media don't have the remedy. It don't have the medication. It don't have the deliverance that you're in need of. Amen. So leave them statuses alone and get to God. Amen. So, you know, I just wanted to say that, you know what I mean, to them, man, get to God. Now, let me also say this. Some of you, you know, grew up in families and grew up in homes where you always got made fun of. You might not feel like you was as handsome as your brother. You might not felt that you was as beautiful as your sister. You didn't feel like you was as pretty as your mother. You didn't feel like, you know what I mean, you was that guy. So a lot of you are depressed because you didn't feel like you was that guy. Or you don't feel like you that bitch. You know, because of the way you look. You don't like the way you look. You don't like your appearance. You don't like your body. You don't like your face. Some of you don't even, oh my Lord. Some of you don't like the color of your skin. And it keeps you in a depression. You know what I mean? You look in the mirror and you don't like the individual that you see. You don't like the woman that you see. You don't like the body, you know what I mean, that you see. You know, you're a woman and your titties is little. You're a woman and your booty is the best definition of small. You know, you're not, your body's not gangbanging. When you, it's a difference between, you know, when you post on Instagram and when your sister posts on Instagram. It's a difference from when you post on IG and when your friends post on Instagram. You know, because your sister always been thick. Your sister always been shapely. Your sister always had titties. Your sister always had a ass that was gang banging. Your sister always had a booty that you could see from the front. But amen. You know, sometimes, you know, people feel like they can't see your booty through God's eyes. And because of that, you're in a spirit of depression because you don't like your body. Titties too small. Booty too small. You don't like your lips. You know, your lips too small. Your lips might be too big, or you might, you know what I mean? Some of y'all, you know, you might be cross-eyed. Let's just talk for real. You might be cross-eyed. Everybody in your family eyes are straight, but one of your eyes, you know, is, you know, GD, and then another eye is Blackstone. You know what I mean? Like, you know, one going to the right, one going to the left. You know what I mean? You know what I'm saying? And because of that, you know what I mean? You're in the spirit of depression. Because you don't like the way you look, you know? And if you're a guy, you know, you might be short. Like seeing I'm shorter than Muggsy Bowles, or I'm shorter than Spud Webb with shoes on, and I got shoes on, and I'm not 5'5". You know what I mean? I put my shoes on seeing, and I'm 5'4", by the grace of God. I'm a short dude. You know, you depressed because of that. You know, you've been eating, you've been lifting weights, and you still don't gain no weight. Your chest, you know what I mean? You still got a bird chest. You know, your chest still come up to your neck. You don't have no nest, you know what I mean? And you depressed because of that. You know, you're not growing. You look like you got muscular dystrophy. So now you into it with the world. You know, or you might be a guy and you got a very small, let's just keep it 100. You got a small penis. You know, you got a small, you know what I mean? And let's just keep it real. In the streets, you know what I mean? When we was young as kids, kids are very heartless. I don't know where you from, but in Chicago, we was heartless. We was heartless about everything. You know what I mean? Everything. You know, everything. And I just remember, now I'm gonna give you the 100, right? You know what I mean? It kind of remind me of back in the day, because, you know, back in the day, like I told you, you know what I mean? The girls, you know what I mean? Around 54th and Cottage Grove, man, them girls was bold. The girls on 84th and Dent, man, them girls was bold. They was bold. Seeing what you mean they was bold. I come from an era, you know what I mean, that if you was acting cocky or arrogant, girls would pull your pants down. Girls would try to pull your shorts down and say, let me see your dick. Pull your dick out. Pull your dick out. Talking all of this stuff. Pull it out now. Let me see what you got up in there. Let me see what you got. Let's see if you should be talking all of this mess that you talking. And one of these days, I never forget, you know, we used to play basketball on the crates and things like that, you know, when we was on 54th, right? So check it out. You know what I mean? We playing ball because, see, back in, you know how it was when we was young, man, Jordan was still doing this thing. Everything we seen Jordan do, you know, everything we seen Mike do, everything we seen Penny do, everything we seen Grant Hill do, everything we seen Isaiah do, Charles Barkley do, you know what I mean? We went outside immediately after watching NBC and went, you know what I mean, to the streets, man, to try to mimic everything we saw them do, right? So we just playing ball. You know, being young niggas, doing what we do. And I'll never forget the homie Bobby's cousin. Oh, my God. Lord help me. You know what I mean? This girl right here. Tiffany Johnson. Yeah, she took everybody's stuff out. You know what I mean? That's why I was so glad. You know what I mean? Because it happened for me around 12. Around 12 years old, amen, touch somebody and say, you know what I mean, amen, increase my territory, amen. Let me stop. But anyway, you know, pubic hairs, you know what I mean? You know how it is when you start growing around, now you're in the mirror like, I see you, dog. I see you, you know. Now you putting it on the table. You putting it next to a ruler. You're like, look at that boy. Yeah, grown man business. Oh my God, on stone. Yeah. So, you know, I started kind of feeling myself. You know what I mean? Around 12, I had already got head, you know what I mean, from multiple bus downs. You know, at 12, you know what I mean, I had already knew what it was like. You know what I mean? Because I ain't going to lie. You know, it didn't start when I was older. You know, at 12, I had already knew what it was like for a girl to have a boyfriend and she talking to me on the side. You know, at 12, I'm feeling cocky. You know, I'm feeling very cocky. You know, back in the day, you know what I mean? You didn't have to really have, what was it? You didn't have to be no pretty boy. If you had a reputation for being a class clown or being an idiot or fighting all the time, you know what I mean? If you knew how to fight or if you was like my cousin, you was putting in work, you know what I mean? Girls was going to be on you. I heard about you. You bad. You know, in other words, she want to give it to you. But anyway, Tiffany, man, I don't know why she did that to the homie, man. She should have never did that. But I'm just showing you how depression kicked in and how depression led to, you know what I mean, Chris doing what he did. Check it out. We was playing basketball. We doing our thing, doing what young niggas do. And she just sat up there and was like, oh, no, of course I would wear suits to, you know, service and things like that. But no, I didn't start wearing suits every day till I gave my life to God at 14. But 12, no, at 12, you know what I mean? I was just another little dirty kid just coming outside playing, man. I didn't start getting G'd up until the homie Beasley, you know what I mean, started giving me clothes. You know, and mom, of course, wouldn't allow me to take the clothes home. So I would have to go to Beasley's house, you know what I mean, the change. Because before Beasley looked me up, Sin was coming outside with drug-free shirts on, dare shirts on, jogging pants. You know what I'm saying? We just going to keep it 100, man. You know what I mean? Shout out, man, to Beasley, man. Beasley was the one that was looking out. Him, you know what I mean? Of course, you know, all of the young niggas, all we looked up to Kenny, man. You know, Kenny had a scholarship to go play basketball, but he was like a young hood legend. You know, all of us looked up to Kenny, man, because Kenny would come through the hood. He was coming through with the Benz and the Jag. You know, he was selling dope real early, man. This was the good days, you know what I mean? Especially when Waikita had everything locked down, you know what I mean, in Motown. But that's another subject. But check it out. Hey, man, you know, she was like, she just, I don't know what came over her. She was like, all y'all talking about what y'all gonna be and how you gonna be in the NBA. All you niggas got little dicks. She just came out and just, I don't know what came, because we wasn't even talking about that. She just bust out. You know what I mean? She's like, all y'all got little dicks. Y'all ain't going to the NBA. Y'all ain't gonna do nothing. All y'all got little dicks and y'all gonna be broke. You know, so, you know how all the kids used to, you know how all of us was, I ain't got no little dick. I don't know who you talking to. I ain't got no little dick, man. You know how, you know, we young and corny. You know, I got a monster in my pants. You know what I mean? I got a whole building up in here. Girls like, what? You better ask somebody. You better ask somebody. Ain't no little dicks over here. Yeah, okay, then let me see then. She was like a gangbanger for dicks. She's like, okay, well, let me see then. She with her little girlfriend. She used to have a girlfriend named Kim. You know what I mean? Kim, you know, was a brown skin and thick. She had the biggest booty, you know what I mean, out of all of them. And, of course, Siobhan Robinson, you know what I mean, which basically later on, I ended up seeing later on as Sullivan. But my first time seeing Siobhan Robinson was really, you know what I mean, over there on Cottage Grove, because she used to sit up there and mess around with, you know what I mean, one of the Moes. But look, check it out. She was like, let me see then. Stop talking. Let me see. And her friends, they sitting over there looking, and I'm like, oh, man, they just about to put us there. But by this time, though, I ain't about to get into that, but by this time, I'm feeling myself, man, because, you know, I didn't grow that, you know, man, I'm like, I got weight on mine, so what's happening? But, man, she sat up there, that was the first time she did Chris like that, and she just grabbed his pants. He's like, man, stop playing with me, and she yanked his pants, and, yeah, man, I ain't gonna get into all that, but let's just say, you know, the ladies thought that the homie was coming up short, right? So they clowning him and everything like that. And he started, of course, he cursed her out and everything like that. But because, you know, children, we roasting them and everything like that. Man, he came back the next day. This is what I mean by that depression. You know, and some of you guys are older, y'all laughing, but some of y'all is dealing with that. Some of y'all in y'all 30s and 40s, man. And y'all think the same way Chris did, you know what I mean, as a little boy. You know what I mean? But because, you know what I mean, he got clowned, you know what I mean, for having a little dick. Man, he came back the next day, man, ready to stab Tiffany up, man. You know what I mean? He wasn't playing no games. You know what I mean? He came back the next day ready to stab her up. You know what I mean? That depression kicked in. He was ready to sit up there and catch a case. You know what I mean? Because his manhood at an early age was wounded. Rob, you know, see, Rob, you from the, I'm not going to go into everything because, you know what I mean? I ain't trying to put everybody report card on YouTube. But, hey, man, listen. Listen. You know what I mean? Let me just say, back in them days, in them eras, man, hey, man, when a little kid, when his manhood, when his ego gets scarred like that, man, he's ready to kill. So when you seen a lot of guys like, man, he gangster, or man, he's a killer. Hey, man, you know what I mean? There's different reasons what made, you know, guys like that. You know what I mean? You can't play with everybody like that, you know? And of course, she was nowhere to be found, you know, during that day. But, you know, thanks be to God, God protected her. And plus, I ain't gonna lie, Chris would have got deleted because, you know what I mean? She would have got deleted. Her family was highly with the business. You know what I mean? Bobby wouldn't have liked that either. But yeah, I'm just showing you, man. You know, I just told that story to sit up there, man, and let it be known that, you know, some of you guys are even in your late 40s and you still thinking about your dick, man. You know, my dick ain't big and you don't feel like you're a man because you got a little dick. You know what I mean? You feel like, hey, matter of fact, I'm gonna just take it there. You know, the stuff that Will Smith is doing right now, hey, man, some of y'all, you know what I mean? That's the reason why y'all agree with that, because y'all got that Will Smith spirit. You know, why couldn't I be like Pac? Why couldn't Jada like me? I wanted Jada to look at my dick the way she looked at Pac's dick. Why she couldn't look at my balls the way she looked at Pac's balls? Why? Like, come on, man. That's stuff that, you know, we should have had outgrew. But I understand that some of you is in your second and third childhood. And so that spirit of depression is still there because you're comparing yourself. Let's deal with it. That's another way that the spirit of depression comes in, because some of you keep comparing yourself to other men. You're comparing your dick to another man. That's why a lot of you can't even sexually please your woman. You can't feel like you're that dude because you're looking at porn. Oh, let's talk about it. Some of you got a porn addiction. You got that porn demon, and you're comparing your body to another man. You're comparing your dick to another man. And that's not manly. That's not, you know what I mean, becoming of a grown man. You in your 30s, you in your 40s, you in your 50s, you know what I mean? And you're comparing your body to another man. You always gonna come up short when you compare your blessing to somebody else. Somebody always got something or a gift or something else that's better than yours. That spirit of comparison will always lead to depression. The word of God say your gift will make room for you, but you can't manifest, appreciate that, Rob, but you can't manifest your gift when you comparing yourself to another man. That's why I told y'all, some of y'all should just turn Instagram off. Turn Facebook off. Because I totally agree with Kevin Gates. He knew what he was talking about. He said, I had to leave IG alone, man, because, you know, I'm comparing myself to people who showing nothing but the A's on there. They showing nothing but their highlights. They not showing failures. They ain't showing mistakes. They not showing hurdles. They not showing the F's on their report card. They not showing previous abominations. They not showing situations that they came short in. They only showing their highlights. And that ain't real. You don't get to see the person that you idolizing and having praise and worship service for. You not seeing their failures and you comparing yourself to a person's highlights. Some of you niggas watching porn and you comparing yourself to this man that dick bigger than yours, but his mind ain't bigger than yours. Personality ain't bigger than, he ain't got the accomplishments that you got. He don't know what you know, but all because he got a bigger and longer dick, you feel like, you know what I mean, that you not this man or he greater than you because you're looking at a highlight. You're not seeing this person in totality. And furthermore, let me say this. You know, y'all can call me old-fashioned all you want, but certain things just never did anything for me. Never did. You know, women having sex with women, women licking and lapping on women, women tasting other women, just licking and lapping. It was always confusion for me. And when it came to porn, you know, I'm a selfish, arrogant guy. I was like, man, that should be my dick that she's sucking on. That should be me that, you know what I mean, this is going on with. You know, so I never had a porn addiction. I never wanted to see women with women. I never wanted to, you know what I mean? So I never had that problem. But I know if I entertain that porno demon, I would have the spirit of depression just like you. You're looking at guys that have popped a pill. You're looking at young guys in their 20s who's on Viagra. These guys be on Viagra and all type of drugs, and you looking at him, you know what I mean, inside this broad for almost an hour or over this hour, and you're comparing yourself to him like, ooh, man, you know what I mean? He didn't sit up there and gave it to her, you know what I mean, for almost 2 hours. Like, man, ooh, I'm barely going 7 minutes, man. I got a man. So now you feel less of who you are because you've been given a broad 420 seconds in comparison to his 120 minutes on drugs. Does that make sense to you? You're comparing your, you sitting over there comparing your 420 seconds inside your woman's coochie, and you're comparing yourself to somebody who's on drugs. A lot of them guys is on drugs, and you comparing his 120 minutes of drilling on drugs. Stop comparing yourself to another man. Furthermore, I want to tell you also, you're entertaining homosexual spirits, sir. Oh, let's keep it real. The spirit of homosexuality is knocking at your door. Sir, why are you comparing your penis to the penis of another man, sir? Let that go. Let that go. You're entertaining homosexual spirits. You're entertaining thoughts that will lead to results, you know what I mean, in other things, sir. You need to leave that alone. Appreciate that 10, bro. You need to leave that alone, sir. The enemy sees that you're entertaining thoughts. The enemy sees that you're having thoughts about, you know, why your penis ain't this, and, you know, why you not this size, and, you know what I mean? Why I'm not this? Oh, man, appreciate that 20, famo. Good looking, man. If I haven't acknowledged you, as a matter of fact, let me look. If somebody sent a Cash App, because some of you be talking about these women, like, ooh, these girls, they getting BBLs, and hold on. Damon, I appreciate the 10, and Mario, I appreciate the 50. Thank you. Good looking. Appreciate them Cash Apps. You know, appreciate them Cash Apps, fam. But yeah, man. You know, you're allowing homosexual spirits of homosexuality to minister to your mind. And that's not cool. That's not cool that you thinking about another man's penis, fam. Some of you downloaded, oh my God, let's talk about, some of you have downloaded videos from Pornhub. Some of you, you know, are on Pornhub every day. You have a Pornhub addiction. Some of you are you on everybody's OnlyFans. You on everybody's OnlyFans. They can always count on you. You hit the like button before the video even get posted. That's how much of a demon that you have. The girl ain't even posted the video yet. You already liked it. I didn't even know that was possible. You didn't hit the like button before the video even got posted. You a cold dude. You're nasty. Amen. You're comparing yourself to another man. You should not be looking at porn. Amen. The Spirit is telling, leave the porn alone. Leave it alone. Within that porn demon is the spirit of comparison. Within that spirit of comparison, there is spirits of homosexuality ministering to you. And if you keep having those thoughts, it will be results the other way, son. Don't minister. Don't let that spirit minister to you. You're laughing, but some of y'all laughing. This ain't even a laughing matter. You know, I'll give you an example. Watch this. And I know some of y'all gonna be like, oh, seeing you cold. You're a cold dude. Hey, check it out. When Johnny Cash had Freeze saved in his phone, follow me now. When Johnny Cash had Freeze saved in his phone with his shirt off, and he showed his wife Freeze and said, this is what he want to look like. Do you not understand that, you know, I know Johnny did that. You know what I mean? He was sincere when he did it. You know what I mean? I'm not making jokes right now. I'm being absolutely serious right now. But by him comparing himself to another man, when he did not fulfill it, because as you can see, he's still overweight. He's still out of shape. He still has not lost the weight. He compared himself to another man. Let me show you something. Walk with me. Oh, my God. Let's walk through this truth. The reason why I was able to lose over 200 pounds, fam, all right, is because I have my own mind. I didn't need nobody to encourage me, lift me up. And I love Freeze, but I never compared myself with Freeze. Freeze never provoked me to lose weight. Why? Because when I was big and out of shape, I was still knocking hoes. I was still having money. I was still doing my thing. But when I got out that spirit of depression, when God blessed me and when the game, you know what I mean, elevated me out of the spirit of depression from after when my mama died. Because like I told you, all of us, you know, got certain drugs. Amen. And some of you right now, you're over 200 pounds, 300 pounds. I'm talking to you women. You're over 200 pounds, over 300 pounds. Oh, my God. 400 pounds. You're in a spirit of depression. You can try to convince them people around you. Oh, you know, I'm happy. Everybody ain't meant to be. Everybody ain't meant to be skinny. Everybody not meant to, you know, God got skinny folk. God got fat folk. Listen here. God ain't got no folk that's out of shape. See, one thing about the church, they would preach against masturbation, want to preach against fornication, want to preach against homosexuality and murder and pimping and everything like that. But one thing the church needs to start preaching against is obesity. Need to start preaching against hate. Because every time you put McDonald's in your body, every time you put that Burger King in your body, every time you put that KFC in your body, every time you put that Popeyes in your body, you are putting hate in your body. That's not love. That's not love in your body. You're not putting love in your body. You're not putting, you know what I mean, love, and you don't have an addiction, you know what I mean, with love. You don't have a love addiction, because if you did, it's impossible for you to put death in your body. It's impossible for you to go to church and listen to the pastor preach about love, and he preaching love this and love that, and then after service, y'all go eat a whole buffet of hatred. You go eat a whole buffet, you know what I mean, of depression. You just got through listening to a message talking about progression, but then you sit up there and went to a restaurant on One Accord and you ate a whole bunch of plates of transgression. You ate a whole plate of depression. You are what you eat. You on drugs too. P, that's Mama Sherman. Mama Sherman on drugs. P, that's Sister Betty. Sister Betty on drugs. P, that's Sister Mitchell. Sister Mitchell on drugs. P, that's Sister Shirley. Sister Shirley on drugs. P, that's Bishop Banks. Bishop Banks on drugs. Just because you're not putting cocaine in your body, just because you're not putting heroin and you ain't doing crystal meth, I want you to know that it's the same spirit within that. Oh, I'm gonna lose weight. Oh, I'm about to get in shape. Oh, I'm about to go to the gym on Monday. Oh, I'm about to go to the gym on Tuesday. Oh, I'm about to go to the gym. I'm gonna start in December the 1st. Oh, I'm gonna start New Year's. When you're serious about loving yourself, the time has always been right now. The time has always been right now. As a man thinketh, so is he. Why wait till tomorrow? You don't even know if you're going to live tomorrow with the way that you eat. Some of you are on your way out of here and you don't even know it. You're not going to die by a bullet. You're not going to die, you know what I mean, from gang violence. You're not going to die from a sexual incurable transmitted disease. Some of y'all about to die, you know what I mean, from that disease called depression. You putting that hate in your body. Some of you have great ministries. God called you to preach. God called you to teach. God called you to do the work of an evangelist. And you won't even be able to fulfill your goals and accomplishments in God because you're out of shape and you keep messing up the temple of God. God said, I can't dwell in an unclean temple. And you putting uncleanness in your body every damn day. You on drugs. Touch somebody and ask somebody, are you on drugs? Say that in the comment section. Are you on drugs? Just because you're not getting high off crystal meth, just because you're not getting high off heroin, just because you're not getting high off coke, that don't mean that you're not on drugs. Look at the stuff that they putting in that food. This is to kill the black man. This is to kill the black woman. You're on drugs. I don't care who I offend. Oh, P, that's my mom or that's my father. You know, they've been in the church. They've been living for God all these years. I'm not saying that they're not men and women of God, but I'm telling you that that spirit of gluttony, that don't got nothing to do with God. Your body is the temple of God. You got to treat it like it's the temple of God. You can't be telling me that the spirit of God that resides in you, abides in you, and you putting uncleanness in your body every day. Loose here. That ain't got nothing to do with that. Let us go higher. If you gonna claim that you a man or woman of God, be a man of God in totality. Be a woman of God in totality. Don't pick what you like and what you dislike. I'm saved. I've been abstaining from fornication. And the reason why I'm self-righteous and because I'm a man of God, I don't masturbate. I don't fornicate. I don't have profanity coming out my mouth. And I dress like this. And I don't listen to secular music. I listen to nothing but gospel music. And I'm always going to church. And I'm always at church events and things like that. But look at all of the souls that you're hindering, you know, from coming to God by you not taking care of the temple of God. The first thing that people see is your physical appearance. Your physical appearance is a reflection of your mind. Oh, my God. Thank you for the 10. Your physical appearance, your physique, your physicality is a reflection of your mentality. Mm-hmm. The way you can carry yourself, the way you conduct yourself, the way you look. If you look fat, if you look out of shape, it don't matter what Louis Vuitton, Gucci fit. Oh man, I got on $3,000 this, $5,000 that, $1,000 this. Yeah, but you ate 5,000 calories. You ate 5,000 calories this morning. Oh, we got to get it together. Touch somebody and say, we got to get it together. I love you. That's because I got to tell you the truth. Amen. I didn't get where I am, and I'm not going where I'm going because I'm comparing myself to another man. Didn't nobody have to encourage me to do that? I saw the error of my ways. I seen the error of my ways and I seen the weight that I have gained. And one thing I love about the lifestyle of pimping and hoeing, hoes will keep it real with you. Touch somebody and say, hoes will keep it real. Touch somebody and say, black hoes will keep it real with you. And I told y'all about that time. You know what I mean? Let's just tell it like it is. You know what I mean? I don't care who pride get hurt, even mine. Let's just talk about me. Let's get back to me. Hey, check it out. You know, one of my ex-hoes, when I had at the time, she kept it all the way real with me. She said, can I talk to you? I said, what's going on? She said, now, I don't want you to get, you know, offended, you know, because you know how you are. I'm like, know how I am. You know, like you saying, you know you arrogant. But, you know, yeah, you know, you doing too much. You letting yourself go. What? I'm just letting it be known. You're not hitting this the way you used to hit this. When you got out of prison, you used to tear this up. You know, now you sweating. Oh, man, pride all the way hurt, but I couldn't do nothing. But she like, now you sweating, you know, and you just had got in and you already sweating. You know what I mean? It used to be a time, you know what I mean, when you used to tear this up. It ain't like that no more. You know what I mean? You out of shape. You sweating, and man, because one time I had to laugh myself. She said one time you was in this and you didn't even know that I seen you. While I was hitting it from the back, I got my head to the sky. You know what I mean? Because you know, listen, man, that's a cold thing. When you out of shape, when you fat, and when you got to sit up there, you understand? Because see, thickness look good. You know, it'll get you on hard and everything. But when it's time to perform, you fat, she thick, you got to separate the cheeks and all of this. Man, it's work. Touch somebody and say it's work. You know? And you know what I mean? She was like, you was just sweating. You had your head to the sky. I was like, what is he looking at? Hey, she said, what is he looking at? You know, what is sin looking at? Why is sin like that? Why is he sweating? You know, like, why you got your head up to the sky? Why are you sweating? We just got started. What did you sweating for? So it takes, and you know what was the final one? This was like the final bruise to my ego. We just talking about myself right now. But this is what really killed it right here. When she said, you know what I mean? And, you know, I'm just telling you this, you know, because, you know, you be talking about, you know, how, you know, you got to stay focused. And I was listening to you the other day and I just thought to myself, like, you know, you said that you know, was going to see this when it come. And if you an egomaniac like me, you know what I mean? It's going to mess with you. Especially when a woman tell you this and you was just teaching about staying focused. And I was like, well, why he didn't stay focused on his diet? Why he didn't stay focused? You know, I was like, wow. Wow. But she wasn't doing it to be nasty. You know what I mean? She was just doing it out of love. Because if you've ever been with somebody who was attractive and you've been with them at their best, and to see them, you know, look a mess, like, I'm gonna just keep it 100, man. Somebody need to go talk to BG Knockout. Appreciate that 20, fam. Somebody need to go talk to BG Knockout. I was just scrolling through YouTube and a Vlad video came up with BG Knockout. I seen the thumbnail for it. I said, oh, man, What I said, what in the fasheezy? What has BG Knockout been eating? Oh, my God. Why is his face like that? Why is that man's neck like that? Lord Jesus, this man got Danky neck. Oh my God, let me stop. They're gonna go back and tell Danky. But man, why is your neck that big? You know when somebody's neck is so big, they gotta get their shirt custom made. You know, when their neck is so big, you know, they can't button the first button. They always gotta, you know, let two buttons off so they neck can breathe. I'm like, man, what is up with this gyro Italian beef neck? What is up with this? You know, because see, in our family, we bottom heavy. All the women bottom heavy. The guys have to work out. You can't be fat because in our family, we bottom heavy. So you in our family, you would get fat. And yeah, you know what I mean? You might pick up some weight in your face, but in our family, you know what I mean? You just, you know, you have to if you're a man. You know, because in our family, especially on mother's side, you know what I mean? Everybody pretty much hips, thighs, all that. So you have to work out. But some of y'all, it's different. Some of y'all, when you eat and when you get out of control, it goes to your face. It goes to your neck. And now you can't button your shirt. You can't, your face, your jaws. You know what I mean? It just looks like, wow. I said, somebody needs to go talk to, and I'm not saying this to be funny, but I'm very concerned about BG Knockout. Because this is somebody, hey, let's keep it 100. BG Knockout would be somebody that the ladies would have said, oh, he's nice or whatever. When you look at BG Knockout in the Real Compton City G's video, and you compare that man to the guy that's on Vlad right now, you're like, man, what happened? How did you go from BG Knockout to looking like Reggie White before the surgery? You looking like Officer Reggie White now. You know what I mean? Like, man, what happened to him? But like I said, some of you, you've never seen how handsome you are. Some of you women never seen how beautiful you are because you're out of shape. Some of you are in your 20s. You look like you're in your 40s because you have that weight on you. Some of you are in your 30s. You're looking like you're in your middle 50s because you have that weight on you. Some of you are in your 40s and you look like you just made 70 years old because you have that weight on you. It's only like a few in the population that has weight on them and they're still, you know, handsome or, you know, she's still beautiful. She's still pretty. She's still something to look at. But most of you, when you get weight on you, you put a lot of age on yourself. You know, you look old. You look terrible. You need to get it together, you know. And I'm just telling you, you would make it, you would lose weight naturally and faster if you stop. Let me just say this before I move on to my next subject. If you stop comparing yourself. Yeah, Snoop smoking and drinking things like that, that's quite different. I don't know why you brought Snoop up. When you getting high every day and drinking every day, that's totally different. I don't know why you brought Snoop up. But, you know, you would lose weight. And I've taught you guys the best way to lose weight naturally. And if you want to lose weight, if you really want to see quick results, then that means that you got to have that discipline to only put water and fruit in your body. I've told you that. I told you that, man. You know, and let me say, oh, I'm glad you said that. Everybody always said that everybody's body is different. And yes, that's true. But don't let that be justification for why you keep putting abominations in your mouth. You know, I want you to eat to live and not live to eat. Amen. Some of y'all need to even get that. Get the Honorable Elijah Muhammad's book. You know what I mean? Eating to Live. You need to get that. Oh, saying I'm not in the Nation of Islam. You don't need to be. Hit that like button. I want everybody to hit the like button because the things that I'm saying within this video, it definitely needs to be heard. Some of you guys can't prosper because you got so many cancerous thoughts. Lord, do something for my mind. Why am I comparing myself to other men? Why am I comparing myself to other women? That spirit of comparison, it will mess up your mind every time. These are not the thoughts of God. These are not pure thoughts. These are not righteous thoughts. These are not healthy thoughts. You need to be content with what God blessed you with. Amen. Whatsoever state I'm in, I've learned to be content. You need to be content with what you have. You need to be content with what God has blessed you with and stop comparing yourself to another woman. Woman, stop comparing yourself to another man. Man. You need to stop comparing yourself. That's why a lot of you have that cheap perfume of jealousy on you right now. It's because you're comparing yourself to someone else. As a man thinketh, so is he. If you continuously keep comparing yourself to somebody else, if you're comparing your daily life, you're comparing your life in totality to somebody's highlights, you're going to fail every time. Stop looking at social media and comparing yourself to the fake world of social media. I keep saying, once again, only the A's are posted on social media. They don't post their failures. They don't post that. Appreciate that five, bro. You know what I mean? You know, they don't post their failures, hurdles in life. They only want you to see the good part, the happy endings. And you're comparing yourself to that. Stop doing that. Maybe God is using this video to tell you to turn off social media for a while. Amen. We got like 50 days, you know, until New Year's. Maybe you need to go on a 50-day fast away from the internet. The price of success is sacrifice. And maybe one of the sacrifices that you need to make is social media. The price of success is sacrifice, and maybe you need to sacrifice Instagram. Maybe you need to sacrifice Facebook. Maybe you need to sacrifice TikTok. Maybe you need to sacrifice Tag. Maybe you need to sacrifice Tinder. Maybe you need to sacrifice YouTube. Maybe you need to sacrifice video game. Maybe you definitely need to sacrifice Pornhub. Sacrifice. The price of success is sacrifice. And you need to sacrifice anything that is perverting and bombarding your mind, you understand me, with the spirit of comparison. Let that go. Hey, maybe so, Andre. You know, maybe the spirit, you know what I mean, is leading them to this to be the last video for some. You know, I mean, I'm getting new subscribers and new people every day. I'm not going to lose nothing. Trust me. The game is the game. As long as I got the game, I'm gonna be all right. But maybe for some, it's telling you to just delete all your social media apps off the phone for the remaining of the year and to just read, work out, meditate, educate yourself, abstain and refrain from talking to people who have nothing to offer. Leaving benefit and leaving people who don't benefit you alone. That's what you need to do. If they're not beneficial, they're not official. If they can't give you no edification, no inspiration, no uncommon information, then why are you even having a conversation with them? There's no elevation there. So if you're talking to people where there's no elevation, amen, the spirit is speaking to you right now saying separation. Separate yourself. Separate yourself from people that don't help you elevate. They don't say anything to help you grow. They don't do anything to help you grow. Leave them alone. Stop becoming a garbage can for stupidity. Stop becoming a garbage can for ignorance. Stop becoming a garbage can for demonic and satanic spirits. Stop becoming a garbage can for the spirit of depression. Stop becoming a garbage can for the spirit of discouragement. Leave it alone. Some of you have become a garbage can for negativity. You know what I mean? Get out of that spirit. The spirit of God is speaking to you, pulling for you, compelling you to come out of that. Because if you do not start today, if you don't make endeavors, you know, to start loving yourself today, it might not be a tomorrow. Some of you are on the verge, like I said, of going to the graveyard. You're putting salt, too much sugar in your body every day. You're killing yourself slowly and you don't even know it. You're getting ready to have a heart attack and you don't even know it. You're not even 40 years old and you're getting ready to have a heart attack and you don't even know it. You're not drinking water each and every day. Before I even start my messages, before Freeze starts his messages, let's make water cool. Let's make water the thing. We've glorified drinking alcohol, and we've glorified alcoholism. We've glorified smoking weed. We're glorified, you know, we made songs about syrup. When, you know, make songs about water. Let's glorify water. Teach the hoe how to drink some H2O. Yeah, put the H2O in her body. Some of y'all done taught the hoe how to drink syrup, how to smoke this and how to take this. You got the interview weed. You got the interview meth. You got the interview alcohol. You got the interview dick. You got the interview head. You know what I mean? Man, you got all of that but some pimping. But hey, man, check it out. What about the interview water? Yeah, get the interview water. You know, get you some fruit. Some of you guys are making enough money where you could literally go to Whole Foods whenever you want. Some of you can't afford that, I understand. But some of you can. You can really live that Whole Foods lifestyle where you, every time you come to Whole Foods, you're spending $100 to $200, $300 or more, you know, every time you come. You know, you have that type of money. There's no excuse for you. You're mobile, you're generating enough income where you can live that Whole Foods lifestyle. You can go to Whole Foods grocery store and just get whatever vegetables and fruit that you want. You can go get you some organic this. You can get you some organic that. You can afford it. You have no excuse. You have no excuse. A lot of that water that you guys are drinking is trash. That's why I told you, you need to be coming to, you know, my Patreon. I'm posting almost every day, you know what I mean, information pertaining to water. What waters to drink. Don't just drink water. Drink the right water. Because some of those waters that you guys are drinking, ain't no alkaline. Ain't nothing in there. You know what I mean? You drinking filth. You know what I mean? You drinking filth, man. That's why I said you need to study. Stop putting destruction. Stop putting this mess in your body. You know what I mean? Take care of yourself. Love you. Oh, let me say this before I go on to my next man. Some of you are eating depression. Hey, amen. The spirit of depression is in some of them foods, man. That's why when you get up, you know, like, man, I just got up. Why am I tired? Man, why I just got up. Why I don't have no energy? Man, man, my woman want to have sex. Man, why my dick ain't working? Man, she wet. But, amen, there's no spirit of resurrection around my dick nowhere. That's because you're killing your dick every day with the sugar that you're putting in your body, sir. Sin, I don't smoke. Sin, I don't drink. Yes, but you drink, you know, orange juice. Like your life depends on it. You're putting all of this sugar, you know, in your body. You're killing your dick. You're killing your erection. You know, you need to study. The things that you put, a lot of you are putting in your body, you are killing your erection. That's why some of you that's in your 30s, some of you that's even in your late 20s, you're starting to realize that your dick is not as hard, you know what I mean, as it used to be. That's because you're putting things in your body that's killing your erection. You're putting things in your body that is killing your erection. Like, man, my dick ain't as hard as it used to be. Or, man, you know, how come, you know what I mean, with my wife, or how come my woman, how come, you know, when it was time to perform, I couldn't get up there? And you're not even 40 years old. That's because of the things that you're putting in your body, sir. You're killing your body. You're smoking. Look at the cigarettes that you're smoking. You're smoking cigarettes, you know what I mean? As if somebody got a gun to your head forcing you to smoke cigarettes. No wonder you can't get up there, sir. You know? So, like I said, it's reasons to why. Check this out. Some of you know the difference between right and wrong. And because you keep doing wrong, that brings a spirit of depression. Because you know that you're doing wrong. You know? When you're doing right, there's a confidence that comes with that. When you're doing right, there's a joy that comes with being right. Amen? There's a joy that comes with doing the right things. When you're doing that which is right, when you're living right, there's a joy within living right. There's a joy within doing, you know, the right things, eating the right things and working out. You feel good about yourself. The reason why there's a spirit of depression there for some of you, because you're doing that which is contrary to that which is right. Oh man, I wasn't even going there. But because I said that, let me just say that some of you are homosexuals. And because you are involved in homosexuality, some of you are involved in lesbianism. You know, you're involved in things that's not right. That's why you're suicidal. That's why you think about committing suicide. That's why you think about, you know, killing yourself. That's why you wish that, you know, you wasn't alive. Because you're involved in activities that's not right. So each and every time that you indulge in that, after the climax is done, after you came, that means the spirit of depression is coming. Because again, you have done something that is contrary to that which is right. So that's why you feel the way you feel about yourself. That's why you feel the way you feel about your life. Because you're not living right. As one songwriter said, what's your life like? You know, when you're not living right, when you're doing things that's contrary to that which is right, of course, you know, you feel, you know what I mean? Man, you feel like I can't go on. I feel like I'm a failure. Yes. Because you're failing God. Yes. Because you're not the person that God called you to be in Him. You're not fulfilling His will. Amen. It's not God's will for a man to be in the anal area of another man. Amen. The first commandment in the word of God is against homosexuality. When He said, be fruitful and multiply, that was against homosexuality right there. You can't be fruitful and multiply in the mouth and booty of another man. You can't do that. Amen. The first commandment in the word of God is against that stuff that you're doing, son. The first commandment in the word of God is against, you know what I mean, the things that you're doing, young woman. You know, that's why even in the pimp game, they be liking that, you know, when girls be licking on each other and kissing each other and all of that stuff. I don't see nothing sexy. I just see two confused broads. I see confusion. You know, they look at it as a way to, oh man, it's a way to pimp, man. And oh man, I like ladies that like the ladies, and I'm not into that. I see confusion. I see two perplexed brides. That's what I see. I see two brides that's confused. I see two brides whose sexual preference, you know what I mean, they should put down abomination. That's what I see. So listen, when you're not doing that which is right, I just had to speak on that for a moment. Now I can bounce back to this. When you're not doing that which is right, when you're not reading, when you're not meditating, when you're not working out, when you're not exercising your mind the same way that you exercise your body, when you're not feeding your mind the same way that you feed your body, and you know that to be right, of course you feel depressed. You're not doing what you're supposed to be doing. It's 24 hours in a day. I don't care what you got going on. You make some time to read. I don't care how many hoes you got. I don't care what, how many drugs you selling. I don't care what your hustle is or what your lifestyle may be or how many jobs you got or what your career is. Amen. You got to feed your mind. You know, you got to feed your mind. You know what I mean? Hold on. Let me do this. I see we got one of them mama raised dudes in here. And I see that you guys keep putting dude on timeout. And I'm thinking to myself, why they keep putting him on timeout instead of blocking him? I don't understand y'all method. Hold on. You know, like the brother should have been out of here. There we go. We keep putting him on timeout for it. He keep trying to disrupt. I've been seeing Lil Mama all in the comment section, you know what I mean, twerking and things like that. Hey, man, when I'm teaching and all of that, I'll be opening up the phone lines. None of these guys have nothing to say but just want to twerk in the comment section. They don't want true answers to their questions. They just want to cause disturbance. They just want to interrupt what's going on. That's all it is. You know, do you have a particular daily diet when it comes to what to eat daily? Like, what fruit do you be eating? As of right now, I eat fruit all the time, brother. I eat watermelon every day. I know to put two bananas in my body every day. You should at least eat two bananas. You know, if you even going to work out, you don't got to put that Subway, you know, in your body. You don't got to eat that sandwich. Amen. You could just grab two bananas and you could get as much as you need from the two bananas. If y'all was on my Patreon, you would already have that game. A man is, you supposed to, if you got the money to do that, you supposed to be eating watermelon every day. You not only have to drink your water, you have to eat your water. You know? So, you know, of course, I'm eating, you know, meat now. I'm eating salmon and sometimes I eat chicken now. But, you know, in the month of December, I thought I was, you know, man, but it was people's birthdays and things like that. So I said, okay, for the month of December, I'm going to go back to just water and fruit, not because of losing weight, all because, you know, during the wintertime, the best things, the best coat that you can put on is water and fruit. Did you hear me? During the wintertime, and to abstain and refrain from having, you know, COVID and all of that stuff in your body, the best coat that you can put on is a coat named water and fruit. That's the best coat that you can put on to protect you from diseases, to protect you from death. The best coat to put on is water and fruit. That's the best one. You know, P, what coat? It's cold outside. I don't want to catch a cold. I don't want to get pneumonia. I don't want to get COVID. Hey, listen, I've never had COVID in my life. I know it's real because others called it. Even Freeze had it for a little bit, you know. But I appreciate the mercies of God because my steps are ordered. I came to Canada before that stuff even took place. And people be catching it out here. I thought, you know, one of my women had it. You know, she didn't, thanks be to God. But, you know, they've had colds. They be catching a cold and things like that. You know, and that's another reason why I like to go back to water and fruit and just putting nothing but water and fruit in my body. Hey, listen, let me tell you, let me show you the difference. If you put nothing but water and fruit in your body for 30 days or more, I promise you, you won't have any boogers in your nose. Sometimes you be hearing, seeing cough. Sometimes you be hearing me sniff a little bit. That's because now I'm eating meats and things like that. But when I'm not putting no meat in my body, when I'm not eating, you know, salmon and chicken and all that type of stuff, and it's just water and fruit, no boogers, no coughing, no none of that. Once you go, you know, 30 days, 60 days, 90 days, 120 days, you know, you start feeling invincible. You feel very invincible. Like when you're working out and you're doing what you're supposed to do, you even notice there's a confidence that comes over you. Like, you know, she want to have sex right now, but does she really deserve all this? You know, like, does she really deserve all this, you know? Seriously. Does she really deserve this? Does she deserve to do anything with me sexually? I'm pure right now. It's a spirit of purity that comes over you. Does she deserve to taste me? Does she deserve for me to enter into her? Does she deserve this sword right now? Does she deserve this man? You know, I don't want you to get arrogant, but I ain't gonna lie. It's the spirit of arrogance that had just come over you. You know, like, I can't do nothing with you. You know, no. Your vibration, your energy, your spirit is just not right. You know? And when you're doing that which is right, like I told you, it's a spirit of confidence that comes with that. And sometimes it's the spirit of arrogance that will come with that. Because when you're loving yourself and taking care of yourself the way that you should be, you start thinking thoughts that you never would have thought if you wasn't in shape or if you wasn't taking care of yourself. You know, by me never being high in my life, I've never been high. I've never been drunk. So, of course, one day I had Freeze laughing. He the only one that would laugh at something like this because we have those same train of thoughts. I said, man, I had just started looking at pictures the other day of people's lungs, people who smoke cigarettes. And I seen their lungs. I said, man, I was like, man, if I could have seen the lungs of certain women that I've slept with in times past, I probably wouldn't have slept with them. If I could see the lungs of different cigarette smokers that I've allowed to, you know what I mean, perform oral sex on me, you know what I mean? I probably wouldn't have allowed her, you know what I mean, to taste this pimping if I could have seen her lungs, man. You know, and of course, you know, if you're in shape or if you're a person that don't, you know, put garbage or stuff in your body, of course, to you, that's funny. But if you're a person that smoke, you know, you'd be like, what? You know what I mean? But seriously, like if I could have seen her lungs, man, I probably wouldn't even, man, just go on Google and look up and look at the lungs. I dare any of you to go to Google right now. You could go to Google and just look at the lungs of cigarette smokers. Look at the difference between the lungs of those who don't smoke and then look at the lungs of those who smoke every day. And you see those lungs, it's like, ugh. And some of y'all have those type of lungs right now. Your lungs is nasty. Your lungs look like Swamp Thing. Your lungs look disgusting. You have demonic lungs because of the things that you've been putting in your body. You know, your lungs don't look godly. You got to stop smoking, man. You know, you really do. You got to cry out to God, you know what I mean, to deliver you from that spirit of smoking cigarettes. That's why your breath smells like that. That's why your clothes smell like that. That's why your lungs look like that. That's why your life looks like that. You got to ask God to deliver you from smoking cigarettes. If you're a woman and you smoke cigarettes, I want you to know that's not sexy. It's not attractive. It don't look good. It's nasty. Your breath stinks. The people at your job and your man probably don't tell you because his breath stinks. And so it's two stinky breath people kissing each other. But I'm here to tell you that your breath stinks. Your breath is nasty. Your breath is contrary to what a clean man wants to smell. Amen. Your breath is currently out of the will of God. You need to rebuke the devourer, you know, by simply, you know, getting you some toothpaste, some baking soda, some mouthwash, and you need to do something that you probably never done in your life. You need to floss. Amen. For there are many diseases and demonic spirits of funk, you know, all between your teeth right now. You need to floss. You need to get those demonic spirits from out your teeth. Amen. If you got purple gums, you know what I mean? Your gums is purple, it's red, your teeth is yellow. You got 3 weeks ago food, you know, between your teeth. I'm here to tell you that your breath stinks. Amen. I might even be talking to some of you pimps right now. And you're saying, oh man, my catch hand sin. You know, what about my mouthpiece? What can I do to increase my mouthpiece? Brush your teeth. Brush your tongue. Some of you are smoking weed. You're eating, you know, a lot of greasy foods. And then you go right to bed. You don't even brush your teeth before you go to bed. And you go to bed with your breath stinking. You wake up with your breath stinking and you walk right past, you know what I mean, the bathroom to get your mouth together. And you walk right to the kitchen to eat and to drink more. And you're nasty. And you say that you're a pimp. I don't understand this. You say that you're a hoe. I don't understand this. You say that you're fly. I don't understand this. You know, I'm just keeping it 100. You say that you're a fly. How are you fly? Because you spend thousands of dollars on name brand clothes that a white man or Jewish man, you know, owns the company of. So you think you're fly because of that? Listen, if you have a nasty toilet, if you have rings around your toilet, and I'm going to even go there. Some of you have the bottom of your toilet is nasty. You have dirt at the bottom of your toilet. You know, you have maybe piss stained yellow or, you know, dirt at the bottom of your toilet. You need to get your toilet together. Sin, why do you say that? Because if you have a nasty house, if you have a nasty bathroom, amen, that can also bring the spirit of depression. Amen. There's a spirit of depression in your bathroom. There's a spirit of depression in your kitchen. You have nasty dishes. You have dishes in your sink right now. Amen. Let this video motivate you. Let this video compel you to wash those dishes. You're a woman. How did you feel comfortable going to bed and you had a sink full of dishes? How did you feel comfortable going to bed and your floor is dirty? How did you feel comfortable going to bed and, you know what I mean, your bathroom, you got panties all on the floor? I even see women in the lifestyle, they be going live, they be going on dinosaurs, and I'm seeing things all on the floor. Woman, you're nasty. And what hurts me the most, you know, is, you know, you say that you're not in need of guidance. I'm looking at the need of guidance all over your house. Socks on the floor, panties on the floor, safety pins on the floor. Why are you having anything on your floor? You know, it makes a clean person nervous because you have the spirit of dirtiness and depression all in your house. And what I don't like is for people to say that they pimps and they're fearful of saying something all because the woman has a physical appearance that they think that's attractive. But I'm here to let you know that you're not attractive if your home is dirty. Sin, I'm light-skinned, I'm thick. Yeah, but your home is dirty. You're nasty. You're ugly to me. Sin, I'm beautiful. Have you seen me? A lot of women, they say that, you know, I'm fine. They say I'm attractive. They say, you know what I mean, I look good. I look like Beyonce in her prime. Yeah, but your house look like you don't say. You might look like Beyonce, but your house look like you don't say. You're not attractive. Amen? What I've been telling you guys, a woman's house is what? Who remember that message? Who remember that one message? The appearance of what? A woman's house is a what? See, they ain't with me. Or maybe I got too many new folk up in here that don't remember. You know, but this ain't nothing new. I've been teaching, man. Is a reflection of her mind. Come on now. You know what I mean? And I could tell her, seeing how you know I'm depressed. All I got to do is, I can see it in the way you dress. I see the way you carry yourself. I see your teeth. I see your nasty teeth. I smell your breath. Amen. You're musty. Amen. I knew you was depressed. I knew you was going through something. Praise God. I can smell, you know, the spirit of depression proceeding from your mouth. Amen. Praise Him. I'm asking God to do something for your breath, and you should be asking God to do something for your breath right now. But I'm making jokes and being funny, but at the same time, I want God to do something for your mind. Because as a man thinketh, so is he. As a woman thinketh, so is she. You know, and some of you feel like life is over. You're depressed. You're not taking showers. You know, you're going, anytime a woman feels, you know, comfortable enough to keep going days without taking showers, we have a problem. We going, wait a minute, stop it. We going days without taking showers, we have a problem. We have, we've gotten so comfortable. Some of these people have gotten so comfortable in their mess that they be going on social media making statuses like, am I the only one that don't take a shower every day? I'm just saying, though. Like, why are you saying, though? And what temperature of comfortability is in your environment to the point where you felt comfortable to make a status or Instagram post? Am I the only one that feels, am I the only one that sometimes go a day or days without taking a shower? Am I the only one? And then you see females in the comments, girl, you're not the only one. Sometimes I just don't be doing nothing. Sometimes I just don't feel like it. I'm just saying, though. Why are you saying, though? Who around you made you comfortable where you went a day without washing your coochie? How did you feel comfortable going days without washing your coochie? How did you feel comfortable enough to come to social media, you know, and talk about this? Come on now. You know, and then you had other, you know, nasty, you know, females that profess to be women coming on one accord with this. You know, like, wow. Got to get it together, man. Definitely got to get it together. You know, but I had to just touch on that just for a little bit. But let me also say this to the guys that feel, you know, like they're less of a man because they're not financially blessed. You know, let me speak this to you. Amen. That's why I like that scripture. I think it's in Ephesians. I think it's Ephesians 3:20 or it's Ephesians 3:21, but I think it's Ephesians, you know, 3:20 when it says, now unto him. See, that's a message before it even get to the rest of it. That's a message within itself right there. Now unto him, not to Facebook, not now unto Instagram, but now unto him who is able not only to, you know, because another scripture say now unto him that's able to keep you from falling. But I like that scripture right there. Now unto him that's able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we could ask or think. And you right now, you might got a job and the income ain't really coming in. Amen. And your mind is messed up because you're currently in a relationship with a woman who makes more money than you. Oh, let's talk about it. You know, I'm not talking to pimps right now. I'm talking to guys that's, you know, in that square world. Hey, you feel less of a man because you can't provide for your child the way you want to provide for your child. And it's not because you don't have the gift. Some of you went to vocational school. Some of you know trades. You know, it's not that you don't have the skill and zeal, you know what I mean, to provide. Some of you have a criminal background. You know what I mean? Some of you have a criminal, you know what I mean, background. Shout out to Rob. Okay, Ephesians 3:20. Thank you, Rob. You know what I mean? Some of you have a criminal background. You have felonies and it's hindering you. Oh, my God. To you young black men who've never been arrested before, you're the real MVP. Touch somebody right now. Give a hand clap for those who have never been arrested before in their lives. You are a legend. You know, you are a legend. See, we glorifying, no disrespect, I like BMF. We glorifying Big Meech and everything. And you know what I mean? And I, you know, I like the series. I'm heavy on my grind. I wish they could take me. Well, I'm heavy on myself. It's hard to make mistakes. Whatever Charlie Wilson be saying, you know what I mean? Wish me love. You know what I mean? Whatever he be talking about. But we glorifying, you know, Big Meech. We need to be giving a big speech and praise and exalt those who have never been arrested before in their lives. Never been arrested. You are a legend. You are to be praised higher than Felix Mitchell. You are to be praised higher than Big Meech. You are praised higher than the Sinful to Pee and, you know, all of these folk. You need to be the one that's praised. You've never been arrested before in your life. Young black man, you got it going on. I don't know if they told you, but young black man, if you don't got no children and you've never been to jail before, you got it going on. You got something right now that money cannot buy. You got your youth. $1 billion can't buy that, man. You never been arrested before and you a black man. Man, you are the, I got to kick the dough down. I got to talk to the youth right quick. Man, if you never been locked up before, man, you are the shit. You've never been locked up before. You've never been arrested before. You've never been through the system before. You are the shit. If you ever see me in person, just walk up to me and say, yeah, Sin, I was listening to you when you was talking about the young men that never been arrested before. Yeah, I'm one of them young men. Hey, man, let me know, man, so I can get your autograph. Young man, if you listening to me, young black man, if you listen to me and I'm ever blessed to see you physically in person and you say, Sin, yeah, I was listening to you when you was giving praise, you know, an acknowledgement to the young black men that never been arrested before in life. You know what I mean? Let me know that, man, so I can get your autograph. Let me know that, man, so I can take your picture, get a picture with you, because you that nigga, you that man. See, they teaching you and they teaching them that the pimp, that the killer, that the drug dealer, that the gorilla, that the demon, you know, is the nigga to be. But if you don't got no children, if you young, black, able-bodied, never been arrested before in life, currently in college, not just in college, not just in school, but see, this is what they don't teach in college. Not only are you endeavoring to get your master's degree, but you have a master's plan with your master's degree. You are them. You the shit, man. You the shit, homie. You the shit. You the shit. Let me know when I see you, man. You know what I mean? Let me know, man. Yeah, whatever you trying to eat. Yeah. Dinner on me. Lunch on me, man. Sin paying for it. Yeah, I'm in the presence of greatness, of young greatness, man. You know, and that's how we need to treat our youth, embracing our youth. That's how you treat our youth. Stop glorifying that which you should be mortifying. Sin, you be giving game about this and that. Yeah, I know, because we got some hard heads. No matter how many times I tell these young people to get their CDL, they still want to go to the path of hell and basically repeat, you understand me, my history or his history or his. So I might as well give what's right and wrong, because it, without the knowledge of what's right and wrong, you know what I mean? They definitely going to be in somebody's jail or prison or graveyard real soon. So that's why I do that. But I've never encouraged nobody to be no pimp. I never encouraged you to get in criminality. I never encouraged you to get in carnality. I wish you would get into a continuity of serving God. But I understand that some of y'all want to do your things with broads and you want to sit up there and have it your way. So since you want to sit up there and come in the streets and do your thing, that's why I provide game. You know what I mean? So you don't do the same things that I've done in times past, man. That's why. But we not glorifying no streets, man. Nah, we don't do that. Ain't nothing but, you know, the graveyard. And ain't nothing but prison in the graveyard and jealous people over here. Let me see. I'm 27 years old from Mississippi. I'm a truck driver. My grandmother and grandpa raised me. I'm on my own truck driving company now. God first. Man, blessings to you, man. 27 years old, presiding over your own trucking company. And you from that Mississippi? Yeah. Yeah, you already know Chicago niggas ain't nothing but Mississippi people that move. You know what I mean? Shout out. Shout out to Mississippi, man. Yeah, love to you, man. And blessings to your grandmama and your grandfather. Praise God for your grandfather, man. Praise God for your grandmother. Amen. 27 years old and doing your thing, man. That brought both of my dimples out. Amen. That brought a smile to my face, man. Thank you. Appreciate that. But no, we're not exalting criminality. Now, if you're going to do it, you know. But no, if I had it my way, none of the young people would come out here to the streets. And for what for? We just had a discussion on snitching. You see, different people got different thoughts. They not on one accord with what's right in the street. Man, this is the worst time to come into the streets. Leave the street stuff alone. Serve God. Take care of your family. Do what's right. You know, you ain't trying to be locked up eating soups and, you know what I mean, talking about some, ooh, hey, CO, could you hurry up and get me a sheet? Yeah, I messed up on this sheet. I'm trying to order, you know what I mean, and trying to get some more, I done ran out of Tang. I need to get another sheet so I can order some more Tang. You don't want to be 20-something years old in jail trying to order some Tang. Trying to order, man, they done ran out of beef contes. I got to get some more chili soups. Like, you don't want that to be your life. You don't want to be in jail and you talking to somebody and another grown man talking about, shh, shh. What's wrong? If the CO hear you, he going to take away from my free time. Look at the spirit of slavery all in jail. Got killers, got hardcore gangbangers and pimps and hustlers talking about some, shh, shh. If the CO hear you, he going to take away from my free time. Got grown men using words like free time. Don't be too loud. Massa going to take away our free time. Listen, to you young men, man, that ain't never been in nobody jail and prison, man, like I just had to take 2 seconds out of my message, man, to tell you, you are the true MVP, man. Keep doing your thing. You are a walking trophy. You are a walking championship. You are the best definition of important, man. Keep doing your thing, young black man. You know, just had to sit up there and let that be known. But to the young man, or to the older man, they feel like he less of a man, that has a family and you're currently without currency, or, you know, the bills is getting paid because your wife is providing. The bills is getting paid because your girlfriend is providing. You know, you feel less of a man because your wife make more money than you. Your girlfriend make more money than you. You know what I mean? You feel less, you know, of a man because you got a revelation of what a man is. Amen. You didn't get the correct revelation of what a man is. You got a revelation concerning what a man is. And because you got the wrong interpretation of what a man is, you think that you're not a man because you're currently without currency. You know what I mean? Hold on, let me see if this is another praise report. I was born in Chicago. Mom Dukes moved us back to Mississippi, where I was raised. I'm now an accounting student. And oh, Mississippi, hold on. Miss with 24 with no kids, shout out to God and you for this game. Bill Davis, man, I appreciate you for the 10, fam. Man, that make me feel good, man. See, like I just like how this game is just touching people from all walks of life. From all walks of life. That just make me feel so good. I keep telling people, man, hey, man, I got more than just pimps and hoes that listen to me. Hey, man, when I do consultation, have you not understand that I've had consultation with ministers? Do you not understand that I've been presiding over a black Hebrew Israelite family for years in consultation? Like, man, you know, this game, man, it touched people from all walks of life. And I love that, man. Thank you, man. I appreciate that. Hold on, what? Adam got accidentally. Yeah, Adam, you tripping, man. Don't do that no more. You had blocked the fam. Yeah, don't do that. But yeah, man, you know, if you're a young black man, you know what I mean, and you feeling like you're less of a man because you're financially not where you want to be right now, I just want to say these words, you know what I mean, to you, especially if you believe in God or you might be serving God, you know, right now. I just want to tell you this, man. as a young man of God, or a person that is believing God, but you're not living for him, I just want to just simply say this to you. You know, many apostles, many bishops, many pastors, many evangelists, many men of God, many great men, you know, before they reach where they got to today, before they became what they became, before they got into the position where they are now, you know, many of them had wives. Their wives, you know, was their support system during the time of need. You know, some of I wish some of these bishops would keep it real with you. You know, when some of those bishops, before they presided over mega churches where they at, you know, I mean, a lot of them, you know, before they went as a minister full time, a lot of them didn't have a job. So the bills was getting paid because the wife was still going to work until things had took off. Amen. So are you saying that the apostle or bishop or pastor or the man of God is less of a man because at that particular time when he went, you know, full time into the ministry, that he's less of a man simply because, you know, his wife at the time was taking care of the bills? No. You know what I mean? That would be laughable, especially seeing now that the husband is a multimillionaire with a number one bookseller and, you know what I mean, a successful, you know what I mean, author and a successful minister and things like that. Come on now. If you know where you're going and you're making sacrifices to be where you want to be, you know what I mean, then don't let this current situation bring any spirit of discouragement. As the scripture said, now unto him that is able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all that you can ask or think. Amen. Don't go to the left. Don't go to the right. Amen. Keep seeking God. Amen. The word of God says, seek ye first the kingdom of God. Amen. And if you continue to just seek God and say, Lord, be a blessing to me. My God, thou seest me. Lord, you see me with my children. Amen. I'm not asking to be a billionaire. I'm not asking to be a millionaire. I just simply want to be a man to my children. I just want to exemplify what a man is to my sons. I want to exemplify what a father is to my daughters. Lord, help me, Lord. Help me be the man that I desire to be in you. And if you faithfully, sincerely, earnestly say that prayer on a daily, God is going to work it out. I believe God and I know God to be faithful and just. Amen. And he will bless you. You just got to keep seeking God and stand before God and fasting in prayer. Amen. And he's going to make a way. He's going to bless you with that career, or give you that promotion. Or when you go full time in the ministry, he's going to give you, you know what I mean, that promotion, that, you know what I mean, that anointing in him. Amen. That audience, that population of people, that congregation is going to come. Amen. Just trust him. Be still and know that he's God. Amen. He's allowing you to go through current adversities and difficulties right now. You know what I mean? So you can know him. So you can know him in suffering. So you can know him in pain. So you can know him in tribulation. That's why God is allowing you to go through the situations that you in. He don't want to just be God to in a book to you. He want to be real to you. How could God be real to you if you never had real experiences in life? Without you having real experiences in life and he didn't manifest his power to you in life, then he would just be a God that you reading about, you know what I mean, through other people's lives. If you've never had a situation where God came through for you, then you just reading about when God came through for others, but you don't know God yourself. Amen. So always remember the crucifixion come before the resurrection, baby. You know what I mean? There's a suffering that come before the blessing. The crucifixion comes before the resurrection. There's a suffering that comes. There's a pain that comes. Amen. It's just like when you go into the gym. You know, many of you said, I want to be built like this man, or I want to be built like this, or I want my arms to be this big. I want my chest to be that big. Amen. But I'm here to tell you that when you're doing things the right way, the natural way, You know, it's going to take a while for you to reach that status. You're going to have to go through that pain. You're going to have to go through something to have everything that you desire. Amen. God has never sent down his fire on an empty altar. Amen. When you look at the word of God, when you look at the old covenant and you begin to look at the high priest, when they went into the holies of holies to make a sacrifice, you never seen any high priest put, you know what I mean, expect, you know what I mean, the fire, the Shekinah of God to come down on an empty altar. Amen. You got to make a sacrifice. Amen. And so during this time of situations and tribulations in your life, you got to be able to mentally respond. You got to be able to hold fast that good, faithful thing. You got to be, you know what I mean, steadfast and unmovable and keep abounding in his word, keep abounding in holiness. So I want to encourage every man that's currently without currency and you temporarily, you know, without currently right now, and you're a father and you're feeling less of a man. I just have to speak to you because there's a depression in that. You know, why I don't have this or why I don't have that. You might don't have a car right now. You might, you know, matter of fact, you might have your family, you and your wife, or you and your woman and your child or your children. You might just be staying with your mother, or you might be staying with her mother. You might be staying over her grandmother's right now. And right now, you don't feel so manly. You don't feel so masculine. You don't feel like a manly man right now. Amen. But just like God, you know, made a way for the children of Israel in ancient times. Amen. I'm here to tell you that he'll make a way for you. You know, he gonna make a way for you. Just be still and know that he's God. Amen. Give him praises if it's already done. Get out of complaining. Get out of the spirit of murmuring. Get out of the spirit of, you know, why, Lord, and just give him praise. Magnify him and get the lesson while you in pain. Get the lesson when you without. So when you finally get the multitude, amen, you will have a sincere gratitude because you know it was God. When an agnostic or atheist try to challenge you, you know, your life experiences is going to shut down all of that. They can come with all of these theories. They can come with all of this so-called historical, irrefutable, you know what I mean, proof to show, you know, this and that. But life experiences are going to always destroy, you know, a debater or somebody who just research. You know, life experiences destroy all of that. Your life, what's your life like? You know, how has God, you know what I mean, came in for you? Like I said, life experiences destroys all of that. Like, oh man, he's the king of debate. This guy, he beats everybody in the debate. He know the reference of this and he know the founder of this. He know how many times this go into that. He know when this was first coined. Hey, all of that's cool, you know, until he come against somebody that's walking in the spirit of humility, that submitted to God, that really had life experiences where God basically did things, you know what I mean, and made a way out of no way. Is that, that's not going to stand up against that. You know? Let me see. Okay. Now that I stood up there, you know what I mean, and deal with that, hold on and do me a favor. Let's see if we get them likes to 900. Minister, stay fly. I ain't seen you in a while. What's going on, fam? Yeah, what's going on? How you been, man? You know, shout out to you, Chi-Town. Yeah, shout out to you. Oh, and right before I leave them relationships, let me just say that some of you are in a depression because your woman left you. Some of you are in a depression because your woman cheated on you or she left you. And I'm here to tell you, man, that you should send that man a thank you card. If somebody knocked you, you know what I mean, for your so-called girlfriend, your boo thing, you know what I mean, and she decided to go be with somebody else, you should have gave that man a thank you card. Because all that man did was show you that it never belonged to you. You thought with all that nasty stuff that you was doing in that bedroom, you thought that woman would never leave you. She told you that she loved you. She did all the nasty things to you, and she called you daddy, and she said that she'd never leave you, and that she loved you, and you believed her. You know what I'm saying? silly little nigga, you know? And, you know, she told you that she'd never leave you and that she always love you and everything, and you believe her. And now she with another man, and you just miserable. You done gained so much weight. Your pecs done turned into titties. You know what I mean? You're not taking showers, you know what I mean, every day. You know what I mean? You done really lost your fly, man. You used to be a fly nigga, man. You used to have your car washed all the time, man. Now you be coming out, your car be dirty. You know what I mean? You got McDonald's bags in the back of seat. You know what I mean? Come on, man. You got French fries all under the seat and stuff like that. You done let yourself go, man. Yeah, you done let yourself go all because this broad left you. I'm speaking to you right now. You know, you done felt suicidal. You done got to the point of depression where sometimes you done actually thought of taking your life because your mind is just so messed up, you know what I mean, over this broad. You know, every time that you, man, I'm about to go deep with it. Hey, check this out. You done been with, you tried to be with other women after her, and the only reason why you was able to even stay up and do your thing is because while you was physically with somebody else, mentally you was thinking about her. And that's why you was physically able to stay up, you know what I mean? Because you was mentally thinking about the times, you know what I mean, when you was with that broad that left you, man. You know, your mind is wrapped up, tied up, and entangled up, you know what I mean, in a broad that ain't even thinking about you. Ain't that cold-blooded? Ain't that cold-blooded? You ready to kill yourself and delete yourself off of the earth for a woman, you know what I mean? You thinking about somebody that ain't even thinking about you. That's cold, man. Man, that's cold. That's cold. You know, she ain't even thinking about you. She done moved on, man. You know, I wish you could see the, like they got a call log. Yeah, I wish you could see the memory log, man. So you could see, man, you not even in her thoughts. You know, you not even in her thoughts. You think about her every day. Listen, fam, you so sick that you've created, you got fake Instagram accounts following her on Instagram, fam. What's wrong with you? You following her on Instagram on different accounts. Fam, she not thinking about you. She not thinking about you, man. She done moved on. She gone. I can't even lie to you. She been looking better since she done left you alone, too. She done got thicker. You know what I mean? She looking all good. I hope she sliding simple to PDM. Hey, baby. But, yeah, man, you need to let that go. You need to realize that that pussy don't belong to you. Yeah, she was just letting you borrow it, man. She was just letting you have, you know, some fun, man, for a little moment. That's all, fam. Yeah, she was just letting you enjoy that thing, you know what I mean, for a little moment, man. You know what I mean? But, yeah, man, that pussy didn't belong to you, man. Yeah, she giving that to somebody else. That mouth that she used to put on you, yeah, man, you know, she giving that to somebody else, man. And I know you like, man, I ain't gonna listen to this nigga. He's a pimp. What does he know? All he knows about is pimping hoes. But I was really in love with it. Look at you. If it is in love, why does it get your big? You know, and I'm laughing because once you let this game come in and minister to you, man, and really bless your soul, you gonna see that. You know what I mean? In all honesty, then, hey, sin was right. What was I tripping on? What was I really tripping on? You're going to be able to laugh yourself like, wow, man, I was really tripping over this broad. I was ready to fight another man over some pussy that didn't even belong to me. What was I tripping for? You're going to be just laughing like, man, look at the sucker stuff that I was on, man. You know what I mean?